रीना कुलकर्णी मैम, जो कि बेंगलोर से है, आज के इस सत्र के लिए हमारे साथ जुड़ेंगे। वैद्य कामिनी धीमान मैम, जो कि एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर है एआई दिल्ली से, और जो को चेयरमैन है डॉक्टर सोनाली धुमाड़े फ्रॉम नागपुर से, वो हमारे साथ जुड़ती हूँ। तो नमस्कार सभी को। और आज की हमारे मॉडरेटर है वैद्य मितुषी शाह, तो सभी का इस सत्र में बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। तो यहाँ पे हमारे साथ वैद्य नवीन जोशी सर भी है, अवेलेबल है। सर से भी मैं रिक्वेस्ट करती हूँ कि वो कुछ प्रास्ताविक करे। सर अनम्यूट कीजिए, अनम्यूट कीजिए सर। हाँ ठीक, 1 मिनट।
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद डॉक्टर शिल्पा जी, आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव के अवसर पर ये कार्यक्रम संचालित करने के लिए, और नेशनल आयुर्वेदा डे तक ये कार्यक्रम चलेगा। और मितुषी शाह जी आप मॉडरेट कर रही हैं, तथा यहाँ पर जितने भी हमारे एक्सपर्ट स्पीकर्स हैं उन सभी को बहुत बहुत स्वागत है कि आयुष और बाल रोग विशेष पर यहाँ पर ये कार्यक्रम है। तो आयुर्वेद में बाल रोग का बड़ा महत्व है, तो आज आपको हमारी स्पीकर इनका परिचय अभी मैडम ने दिया है, अभी आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है अथर्व मंदेकर मैडम। बहुत सारे लोग यहाँ दिख रहे हैं, आप सभी का बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। वैदिक कामिनी धीमान मैडम भी शायद यहाँ अभी तो दिख नहीं रही हैं, अभी थोड़ी देर बाद आ जाएंगी वो भी, तो आप सभी का स्वागत है जी। नमस्कार।
धन्यवाद सर। तो अष्टांग आयुर्वेद पे जो एक वीडियो बनाया है, यहाँ पे मैं उसको शेयर करती हूँ, और इसके पश्चात आगे का मॉडरेशन वैद्य मितुषी करेंगी। I welcome you on behalf of Ayush Darpan team on this occasion of National Day celebration. And now over to you, Dr. Mitoshi.
जी मैम, धन्यवाद मैम। तो आज का जो सत्र है अष्टांग आयुर्वेद, इसमें मैं आप सभी का स्वागत करती हूँ। इस सेशन के ऑर्गेनाइजर्स वैद्य नवीन जोशी सर, शिल्पा हिरमे मैम और अरविंद पाठक सर, तथा चेयर पर्सन वैद्य कामिनी धीमान मैम, जो कि एसोसिएट एचओडी है और एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर है गायनेक डिपार्टमेंट एआईआई दिल्ली से, और दूसरे है को चेयरपर्सन ऑफ सेशन वैद्य सोनाली धुमाले मैम जो कि एमएस आयुर्वेद कॉलेज गोंदिया महाराष्ट्र से एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर है, और मैं मितोषी शाह आप सभी का स्वागत करती हूँ। तो आज के सत्र में आगे बढ़ते हुए हम आज के पहले स्पीकर को इनवाइट करते हैं जो है डॉक्टर श्रीनिधि कुमार आचार्य सर। प्रेजेंटली एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर है डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पीजी स्टडीज नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ आयुर्वेदा जयपुर में। सर ने यूजी किया है एसडीएम कॉलेज आयुर्वेदा कुटुडीपी और उडीपी से, जिनमें उनको डिस्टिंक्शन मिला था तीनों प्रोफेशंस में। सर हैज परस्यूड हिज पीजी फ्रॉम बीएचयू इन 2003। डॉक्टर श्रीनिधि कुमार आचार्य हैज वन मोर फेदर ऑन हिज कैप विच इज पीएचडी डिग्री। सर को 18 साल का सिखाने का अनुभव है जो कि आज हमें बहुत उपयोगी होगा। सर बहुत सारे रिसर्च एक्टिविटीज में भी अपना योगदान देते हैं। सर हैज गाइडेड मोर देन 20 रिसर्च पेपर्स एट पीजी एंड पीएचडी लेवल। वी फील प्राउड टुडे टू इनवाइट पर्सन लाइक सर ऑन दिस प्लेटफॉर्म who has published book of Kaumar Vritya, namely Acharya textbook of Kaumar Vritya. Sir has given more than 30 guest lectures, seminars, CMEs, etc. His face has also been appeared on national television. So, आज हम बड़े गौरव से सर का स्वागत करते हैं। सर का आज का विषय है clinical approach and case studies of diarrhea in children. Welcome, sir.
उपस्थित नहीं है, थोड़ी समय में वो जुड़ सकते हैं। तो डॉक्टर सोनाली
नमस्ते, गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक आयुष दर्पण फॉर गिविंग ऑफरिंग मी को-मॉडरेशन मॉडरेटर हियर, एंड आई वुड लाइक टू अप्रिशिएट दैट टुडेज टॉपिक्स आर वेरी एक्सलेंट फॉर प्रैक्टिस पर्पस, क्लिनिकल नॉलेज और क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस के लिए अपने आयुर्वेद के जो स्टूडेंट्स हैं, जो स्नातक हैं, उनको ये बहुत हेल्पफुल साबित होंगे उनके प्रैक्टिस में, करियर में। सो आयुष, मैं खुद भी बहुत उत्सुकता से सेशंस का इंतजार कर रही हूँ।
हेलो,
यस सर, यस,
आई एम ऑडिबल,
या
आई होप स्क्रीन इज ऑल्सो ऑडिबल,
यस सर, या यू कैन जस्ट मैक्सिमाइज या फुल स्क्रीन।
Yeah, one. Is it working now?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay. चंद्रौकांति अमृतोर करे जयंती संजीवयंती ममितात्मस्कं प्रदेशं ज्ञानं सुधां कलशमिवच संददानौ शीतां पुष्पमण्डलगतं मदतोऽस्मि तस्मै। At the outset, I would like to thank all the organizers of this webinar for giving me this opportunity. I hope I will fulfill your aspirations, and I will try my level best to give some of the clinical knowledge regarding diarrhea in children. So, if you permit, shall I start now?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Yes, welcome. The topic which is given for me is clinical understanding and case discussion on childhood diarrhea. So as I cannot deal the both the topics together because of time limit, I will consider the cases. And while describing the cases, I will try to explain certain clinical points regarding diarrhea in children. Now, without wasting much of the time, we will directly go to the case and we will see the relevant information which is required. See, this is a case, a 12-year-old child, age is 12 year old, and with the recurrent episodes of loose stool. And complaint of the child is recurrent episodes of the loose stools. And he has been suffering from the same problem since last 1 year. And each time he is treated with antibiotics and getting better for a few days. This is a scenario, okay? And child has been having this problem since last 1 year, and there is no loss of weight. Of course, there is significant loss of weight is noticed as the child is suffering from the problem since last 1 year. Mother also noticed that there is a significant loss of weight. Now, when I go for a physical examination, the stool is not sticky and there is some abdominal distension is there. And also there is mild tenderness is there all over the abdomen. So when I tuck the abdomen, there is a mild tenderness. Some sort of abdominal distension is also there and stool is also not sticky. When I go further, there is no hepatosplenomegaly and there is no ascites. And then I go for a CBC. So when I go for a blood investigation, HV is found to be 8 and WBC is 18,000 and the polymorph is 78 and lymphocyte is 18 and eosinophil is 2 and platelet is 5.2 lakhs. And significant is serum protein is 5.7, which is quite lower. And albumin is 2.2 and globulin is 3.5. This is also lower. And this is a case scenario. And now we will see what actually it is and how to deal this case. When such patients come to you, how we can proceed. See, there is recurrent, how to deal. So there is recurrent attacks of diarrhea since last 1 year, isn't it? There is recurrent attacks of diarrhea. So one thing is very clear. This is a chronic problem. This is a chronic problem. This is not acute problem. This is a chronic problem. So one more is loss of weight is there. Therefore, child nutrition is affected. Okay. So because of child affliction of the child nutrition, there is a loss of weight is also seen. So definitely this is something to do with the malabsorption. Malabsorption is there. This is a chronic problem. And in the meantime, there is malabsorption. And when I touch, there is mild tenderness. When the tenderness is there, it suggests there is some sort of inflammation because tenderness is always a sign of inflammation. We know that pain and redness and all this swelling, these are the signs of inflammation. So one thing is clear, it is a chronic problem. There is some malabsorption and also there is inflammation. Now I have to confirm whether this particular inflammation is a infective inflammation or non-infective inflammation. What is the difference? When it is caused by some of the organism like viral, bacteria, parasite, etc., it is considered infective inflammation. When it is not caused by any of the microorganisms, but only body immune system itself creates inflammation, that is called as non-infective type of inflammation. Most of the autoimmune disorders comes to non-infective group. Allergies, they come to non-infective group. Okay. So now, in this case, previous history of antibiotic and good response for the antibiotics is there, isn't it? Therefore, definitely it is quite ensured that infection is there and mostly it is infective inflammation and which is recurrent in nature and it is responding well for the antibiotics. Therefore, it may be bacterial. Okay, viral will not respond well for the antibiotics. So therefore, it may be a bacterial. So next to confirm the same, I have gone for CBC. In the CBC, it is found that it is bacterial origin because WBC is rise to 18,000. Therefore, it is CBC is bacterial origin. Now, abdominal distension is there, so which suggests a point towards or a clue towards electrolyte imbalance because problem is long-standing. Problem is long-standing. Therefore, it suggests towards an electrolyte imbalance. Meantime, there is also low plasma proteins and also the loss of plasma proteins, so which suggests that there is malabsorption. Okay, it's a long-standing malabsorption. So now, at this particular juncture, I can say that this is a case of a diarrhea which is very chronic, associated with the malabsorption and mostly an infective type of diarrhea. And most probably this is a case of chronic inflammatory bowel disease. This is the most common presentation. It's a chronic inflammatory bowel disease, one of the chronic problem. So this is how we can deal with the cases. This is case number one. Let us go for the next case, case number two. A 2-month-old child is passing the loose stools 10 to 15 times. The age of the child is 2 months. 2-month-old child is passing the stools about 10 to 15 days. And I hope slide is coming.
Yes, sir.
Okay. A 2-month-old child is passing the loose stools, and it is about 10 to 15 times per day. Since last 2 weeks, this is a complaint of the mother. Okay. 2-month-old baby, and it is passing loose stools 10 to 15 times a day since last 2 weeks. Prior to that, child used to pass only 3 to 4 semi-solid stools per day. Now, this is what mother says. Just 2 weeks, since last 2 weeks, child has started the increased frequency of diarrhea or loose stools, and that is also about 10 to 15 times. And prior to that, in the first month of the life, the child is normal and it is only passing 3 to 4 semi-solid stools per day. And in this case, mother also says child is completely breastfed exclusively and child is not sick. Although child is passing about 10 to 15 times per day, the child is not looking sick. Child is okay, child is happy, okay, and child is playful. Now, when I inquire further with the grandmother, because mother has came with the grandmother, so therefore I inquired with the grandmother. Grandmother says mother has been started eating the outside food since last 2 weeks. Okay, previously in the pregnancy and later onwards in the puerperal period, so she was restricted about the diet, and now she is taking some of the outside food since last 2 weeks. And according to grandmother, grandmother's knowledge, it is outside food which is causing this problem. Okay, so then I go for the stool examination. In the stool examination, there is some E. coli is present and some pus cells are also present. And very important is some of the reducing substance is present. Reducing substance are nothing but the broken down products of the glucose. So how to proceed with this case? Okay, this is most commonly seen in the OPD level, and how we can proceed with this case. Now, this is very important. Age of the child is just 2 months and it's only taking the breast milk, and baby is happy and baby is also gaining the weight. So when this scenario is there, there is no need to worry. Okay, see, in newborns always, or infants, when the baby is happy and not sick looking and also gaining the weight, that means it's almost a safe case. Okay, there is nothing serious. Now, the complaint is previously passing semi-solid normal stools, but now it is passing loose stools. What may be the cause? Okay, now, but child is normally gaining the weight and happy looking, but the frequency of the stool is increased. Okay, so now, what is the cause for loose stool which started suddenly? In this case, what is the cause of loose stool which is started suddenly? Does the mother's food habit change the pattern of the stool in the child? Is it possible? As grandmother says, she is taking some outside food, maybe carbohydrate rich food she is taking. Is it possible that this particular food will go into change the frequency of the stool? If you talk in terms of fiber, that is possible, because all the food what we take is panchabhautika, and that is converted into rasa. And rasa is converted into the next dhatu, and upadhatu of the rasa is nothing but stanya. Okay, so now definitely whatever which is present in the rasa dhatu is also come to the stanya, and when baby consumes this stanya, definitely it will have its own effect. Okay, now the cause in this case is, if you see the cause, mother is taking some outside food which is very rich in carbohydrate, and this carbohydrate, therefore, breast milk is also rich in carbohydrate. When baby consumes the carbohydrate food, and carbohydrate contains more and more glucose, and glucose is basically an osmotic laxative. Okay, glucose is basically an osmotic laxative. When amount of the glucose is more in the breast milk, then lactase, because breast milk is basically contains lactose, and it has to be digested by the lactase, the amount of the lactase in the gut of the baby is limited. When you give the extra load of the lactose to the baby, definitely some amount of the lactose is get unmetabolized or undigested. And this undigested lactose will now pass on to the intestine and go into the large intestine, because it is not absorbed, because load is more. So when it goes to large intestine, there are some bacteria are there. They ferment the sugar. Lactase is a sugar. So lactose is a sugar. So sugar will be fermented by the bacteria which are present in the large intestine, and as a result, there is production of the gas, some acidic substances, and some amount of the lactose also passes in the stool, and it is identified as reducing substance. Okay, therefore, in the stool, we are finding reducing substance here. So what is the cause? The cause is maternal food, that mother is taking more carbohydrate food, and that was depicted in the breast milk, and baby consuming the same, and as a result, there is inability to digest extra amount of the carbohydrate by a baby of 2-month-old, okay, because lactase deficiency will be there, and that is the cause. Now, again, question comes, there are E. coli and pus cells are also there in the stool. Of course, stool always contains E. coli and pus cells, and if its percentage increases by 2-fold or 3-fold, then only it is significant. Otherwise, in every child and every stool, you find E. coli and the pulsatility is quite normal. But in this case, baby is happy, baby is gaining the weight, everything is fine. The only problem is a loose stool which is coming frequently, and cause for that is excess consumption of the carbohydrate rich food containing lactose. So this is again one more common case which we encounter in a clinical practice. Now go for case 3, one more case we will see. So in this case, there is a 3 month old infant is presented with the loose stools for the last 2 weeks. A 3 month old infant is presented with the loose stool since last 2 weeks, and child is on exclusive breastfeeding. Okay, it's a 3 month old baby and presented with the loose stool since last 2 weeks. Child is taking exclusive breastfeeding. That means exclusive breastfeeding means baby is not taking anything apart from breast milk up to 6 months. Okay, so that is exclusive breastfeeding. Now, here also child is playful and child is also gaining the weight. But thing is, child is also passing urine 12 times per day. But still, the thing is, there is loose stools since last 2 weeks. Stool frequency is about 15 loose stools per day. Mother complains that daily my child is passing about 15 loose stools per day. Do something for this. Okay. And I ask the color of the stool, and she says color of the stool is golden yellow. And duration is from just 2 weeks. And it is progressive. Mother is telling daily it is going on increasing and it is not coming down. Okay, when I ask the color of the stool, it's called as golden yellow. Golden yellow color suggests that yes, it is a breast milk. Okay, breast milk, when child is on exclusive breast milk, the baby will have golden yellow color stool. Okay, if the baby is given some other supplementary food and all, the color may going to change. But here it is, baby is exclusive breastfed. Even in the cow's milk also, you will have golden yellow color, little bright golden yellow color will be seen. Anyway, now here the case is 3 month old baby, which is previously normal. Now it is passing about 12 times per day, passing 15 loose stools per day. And how we have to tackle this problem. Now see, what is important here is we have to look into the weight gain pattern of the child. First thing, in such condition, when the baby is healthy looking, okay, happy looking, playful, you just see whether the baby is gaining the weight normally or not. Yes, in this case, baby is gaining the weight normally. Number two, you see whether baby is passing the urine normally or not. Yes, in this case, baby is passing about 12 to 15 times per day. So it is also passing. Okay, and baby is happy. It suggests that mother is getting adequate breastfeeding. Okay, mother is feeding the baby adequately. There is no problem with the breastfeeding. But still there is a loose stools. Now see, this is a common cause. This is called as exaggerated gastrocolic reflex. Okay, see what happens is whenever mother feeds the child, the breast milk will go and fall on the stomach. As soon as it falls on the stomach, a sudden reflex action is created. And because of that, the peristaltic movements are stimulated. So intestine will be stimulated by the peristaltic movement. And because of peristaltic movement, whatever the stool which is present in the colon or maybe in the rectum or anal area, that will be passed. Okay. So now here, what it is called as? It is called as exaggerated gastrocolic reflex. Most of the time, mothers are worried. They come and say, whenever I feed the child, immediately baby passes the stool. Okay, it is not that the same milk which is given few minutes back, it is going through the stool. It is because of gastrocolic reflex and peristaltic movement. Whatever the stool which is persisting or present in the colon is passed off. And this is quite normal. Why this is quite normal? Because in the early part of the life, the nervous system and enteric nervous system of the baby is not well developed. And therefore, it cannot do the function so precisely. So there will be exaggerated reflex actions will be there. And as a result, there will be gastrocolic reflex. This is quite common in the newborn babies, and most of the mothers complain this. And what you have to do is, you have to convince the mother that this is quite physiological, don't worry. Until and unless your baby is gaining the weight and he's playful, there is no problem. If he is gaining the weight means definitely the whatever you are giving that is get absorbed, that's all. Okay, so what is important is you have to look into the well-being sign. Okay, the baby should, you have to confirm that baby is normal, baby is gaining the weight, and baby is absolutely okay. So this is another important case of exaggerated gastrocolic reflex, which is quite common in the infants. Next, we'll go for another case, a third case, where a 2 month old infant is presented with a history of 7 to 8 loose stools. It's a 2 month old infant. and he is presented with a history of 7 to 8 loose stools day for the last 2 weeks. Baby was absolutely normal in the first few part of the life. Then since last 2 weeks, he is increased loose stools. 7 to 8 times he is passing. Now earlier he used to pass the semi-solid stools 2 to 3 times per day. In the first month, and in the later part of the first month, he is very normal. He is passing just 2 to 3 or 5 stools per day and mother is happy. But now since last 2 weeks, baby is passing more amount of the stool. That's also loose stools. Now there is no other complaint. Again, the child is gaining the weight normally and child is not sick. In between, the child is very playful. Okay. And then I asked, what is the smell of the stool? See, this is very important. If there is a bad smell in the stool, okay, bad smell, foul smell in the stool, then it may be suggestive of some of the bacterial or viral infections, especially bacterial infections. And if the foul smell is not there, sometimes there may be a sore smelling stool. So amliya bhav ho sakta hai. So sore smelling stool. So that is not foul smelling. Most of the parents or mother, they confuse a sore smelling stool with the foul smelling stool. And aap puchenge to they says that bahut badbu aa raha tha. But it is not like that. So there is no foul smelling here and it is non-sticky and also quantity is less. Okay, so stool examination is positive for bacteria. Of course, in the stool always bacteria will be there. And also there is some reducing substances. So that means some glucose is going on. Let us see what is the cause for that. So this baby is absolutely normal for 2 months and since last 2 weeks he started with this problem. Now, child is not sick or thing. Look at the color of the stool. Color of the stool is also normal. See, if the color of the stool is green, then we have to be careful. Okay, color of the stool may be green in case of some bacterial infections like Pseudomonas and all. Yeah. And if it is white, it suggests that the fat is not get absorbed. There is some fat malabsorption problems. And if some other color is there, then we have to worry. But here the color of the stool is normal. So you can say, then I just told the mother, so don't worry, this is what is previously case we have discussed. This is a gastrocolic reflex, nothing worry. Then mother immediately asked me, sir, if it is a gastrocolic reflex, it should be present from the birth itself. But my child is normal up to 1 month. Since last 2 months, this problem is started. Yes, point is correct. Okay, now I have to look into the cause. But now, although there is no change in the feeding pattern of the child, why this change in the stool occur? We have to evaluate the cause. You got the point? I can say for the first sight that this is nothing but gastrocolic reflex. This is quite normal. Your baby is gaining the weight normally. But mother counter asked the question to me, sir, if that is the case, my baby is normal in the first month. Since last 2 months, he is having this problem. Now I have to find the answer for this. Yes. Now here comes the answer. And those who are clinically practicing, for them, this is the most common case of diarrhea which is coming in the newborn or infantile period. Okay, what is this problem? The problem is, see, you have to understand, breast milk is present and breast milk will be ejected, or when the baby take the breast milk, it is taken in 3 phases. One is foremilk, mid milk and hind milk. Okay, so foremilk which is present, so it is always rich in carbohydrate and glucose and as well as water. Okay, mid milk is always rich in proteins, whereas hind milk is rich in fat. Now we always say that when you give the feeding to the child, first emptify one breast completely, then only get shift to the next breast. What is the reason behind this is, if you're not emptifying one breast completely, for suppose a total emptification of the breast requires about 20 minutes, you are giving only 10 minutes feed, then your baby is only getting carbohydrate rich food. Your baby is not getting protein rich food, your baby is not getting fat rich milk. Okay, so there, and immediately you shoot to the next after 10 minutes, there also the foremilk it is getting. In the foremilk again the carbohydrate is rich. So what is happening is, when you frequently feed the baby, so what happens, every time baby is getting only carbohydrate rich food. It is not getting the protein and not getting the fat. See, you just think, if the baby is not given with the fat, how can you expect that baby's weight should increase? It is impossible. Okay, that's one problem. Second problem is, every time baby is getting, suppose you are feeding your baby and by 10 minutes the baby was slept and you stopped. Okay, then after half an hour, again baby wake up, again it start crying and you again fed the baby. Again, what is going on? Again, the carbohydrate rich food is going on, because once you emptify the breast to some extent, within half an hour it will be filled back, and again it will be formal which is coming first. So if you are frequently feeding the baby without emptification of one complete breast completely, and you are not giving sufficient time for the feeding, like 20 minutes, okay, then every time you are feeding the baby with the carbohydrate milk. So carbohydrate, we know that carbohydrate, maximum carbohydrate which is present in the breast milk is lactose. That means again, doing the same mistake, you are giving the overloaded lactose to the baby. And this lactose is not get digested properly because there is no such lactase enzyme to digest all these things. So some of the lactose passes through, and this passes through large intestine, and same process comes and reducing substances comes in the stool. And we know that lactose is a sugar. It is an osmotic laxative, and baby will pass the stool frequently. No, but here in this case, for 3 months it is normal. The first 1 month it is normal. Later this problem started. What happens is usually for the first month, the baby and mother will be isolated and they will be given with a private room. And mother usually spend a lot of time with the mother, baby, and he usually completely give the breast milk to the baby. He gives a sufficient time for feeding. But after 2 months, what happens is baby will be also little active and mother is also get shifted to the outside room. And it is easily disrupted while breastfeeding. When you are feeding the mother is feeding, she will be easily disrupted, and babies also get easily disturbed because family members are going here and there, because babies also little active now, therefore some small voice also, okay, so it will get disrupted and it will leave the breastfeeding. Okay, after half an hour again mother starts giving the feed, again the carbohydrate feed comes. So this is the problem. So in this case, child is also grown little and it will be disturbed by the sound, then family members are also passing through here and there while feeding. Again, this will disturb the baby, and mother feels discomfort while feeding and stop the feeding between. So as a whole, what happens is baby is receiving only one half of the breast milk of one half. That's only four milk it is getting. It is not getting the hind milk. It is not getting the mid milk. So naturally, there is no protein and there is no fat, and we cannot expect that baby should gain the weight properly. So this leads to completion of the only first phase of the feed. So therefore, continuously she feed the four milk only. So this is the problem. Now, so diagnosis, in this case, the diagnosis, normal infant with frequent four milk consumption. Okay, you, whatever the way you advise the mother, so they will not follow this method. Okay, because usually what happens when you are giving the feed, after 5 minutes, baby usually sleeps. And what is expected is you have to awake the baby and you have to continue the breastfeeding till the complete emptification of the one breast. It takes about 20 minutes. When you're not doing this problem, what happens is whenever you are half feeding, every time, next time when you're feeding, it is only the four milk, only carbohydrate. So what happens? There is no loss of weight, but there is no gain of weight because you're not giving fat at all. Okay, carbohydrates are daily utilized for the energy. Therefore, there is no gaining of the weight. But of course, there is no much loss of the weight. So what we have to advise is correct the feeding pattern. Why I'm stressing on this is the most common condition we will get in the clinical practice. Okay, maximum conditions, this is only because of a infrequent, that means faulty feeding habits. See, feeding is a very, very holy phenomena, and it should be done very carefully and with all giving sufficient time. Okay, so somebody is looking, mother is embarrassed because somebody is seeing while she is breastfeeding. See, you just imagine, is it possible to give the proper breast milk to the child? It's not possible. So while feeding, mother should feed the baby in privacy, and only mother and child will be there. They have got their own maternal bonding, and correct the feeding pattern. Empty the one breast first before going to the other one, and don't frequently feed the baby. This is very important. See, this is one more thing. Don't frequently feed. See, there is one practice that whenever mother baby cries, so mother usually feed the baby. Baby will not cry only for the feed. Baby will cry because of so many reasons. Sometimes baby will cry because of fear. Sometimes baby is crying in a need of a maternal bonding. Sometimes baby may cry because of some discomfort or a disorder. Every time feeding is not the solution. Okay, baby may be quiet by 2 minutes by feeding. Okay, because you shut the mouth. Therefore, but the cause is not that. So you have to find out the cause. So if he sleep tickle him and make him awake and again feed. Only leave when he is not awake by tickling also, then you leave it. Usually by 20 minutes when it takes sufficient amount of the breast milk, so he will go into sleep, and by tickling also he will not get up. That suggests that he is totally satisfied, and even protein and fat milk is also going inside, gone inside. Okay, so every time he is crying, don't go for feeding, because sometimes just hug the baby, the crying will stop. That means child is in search of a maternal bonding and love and affection. Okay. And if by hugging also baby is not quiet, then you can go for feeding. And if by feeding also, if the baby is not stop the cry, not stopping the cry, then it suggests there is some discomfort other than all this. Anyway, we have got another case. 8-month-old infant presented with a history of loose stools 5 to 6 times for the last 1 month. 5 to 6 times per day for last 1 month. Stool were greenish in color, but not foul smelling. Again, stool is greenish in color. It is not foul smelling. There is no weight gain since last 1 month. Yes, very significant. There is no weight gain since last 1 month. एक महीने का पहले का जो वेट है आज भी वही वेट है. अभी बच्चा जो है 8 महीने का है. That means in the last, since last 1 month, there is no weight gain. And child was on exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. Child was on exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. And then mother started giving some semi-solid food to the child, infant, but infant refused, is disliked it. So mother has got no option. So she continued the breastfeeding. So when we do the physical examination, it found that nothing is abnormal. Everything is fine, except the static weight gain. Weight gain is same. It is not increasing since last 1 month. Okay, baby is quite happy and active. What may be the possibilities in this case? Baby is having 8-month-old infant, and 5 to 6 times he passes. There is no weight gain since last 1 month, and mother tried the formula made or a supplementary feed, but baby is not taking, so she left the effort, and he is now continuing the breastfeed. Now here, when the stool color is greenish, so that's very typical. Mother says the stool color is greenish. When the stool color is greenish, bile is reaching the intestine in the right time as per the rhythm, but it is not utilized. That means, you know what a green color? Green color will be usually bile juice. Okay, bile juice is having the loose color. Many, many mothers come, complain that jo hai stool pass kar raha hai, wo greenish color ka hai, hara rang ka hai, greenish color ka hai. Okay, so now, so usually green color will be attributed to the bile juice. And of course, green color may be there when you start a supplementary food like Cerelac or some other lactose-free milk, etc. There is also green color will be there. And sometime in some of the infections also, there will be greenish color like Pseudomonas and all. But here, it is greenish color and as well as it's not foul-smelling. So it is not foul-smelling means it's not bacterial. Okay. Now, there is no fatty. Now, in this case, what happens? Usually, all the body secretions like enzyme secretions, so they follow a rhythm. They are producing in a rhythmic way. Okay, so in a rhythm, always the food comes to, bile juice comes to the intestine. By that time, intestine should have some fatty food. Bile juice is meant for the fat digestion. It should have some fatty food. Suppose if there is no fat food when the bile juice comes, now bile juice have no other work to do. Through the peristaltic movement, it slowly trickle down into the intestine and pass into the intestine, go to the large intestine and pass in the stool. And mother says that child is passing a greenish stool. So sometimes this is the cause. So this is one of the commonest cause for what is a greenish stool, and we will call it as usually hunger diarrhea, because you have not given the fatty food there, or when the bile juice is coming, there is no food. So what bile juice can do? It will just go. Okay. So therefore it is biliary diarrhea or hunger diarrhea. This is the cause. So again, what is the cause? Improper way of feeding is again one more important cause. Same cause. When you feed the baby in a particular rhythm, every 3 hourly, every 2 hourly, or maybe every 1 hourly, then this rhythm will be followed. Otherwise, there is a mismatch. When the bile is coming, there is no food. When the food is there, there is no bile. So this mismatch will be there. And this is the cause, because we know that bile is meant for fat, and fat is not get digested. There is no way the increase of weight. There is no question of increasing the weight. Okay. So this is the cause. Now, so in this case, what happens? Mother also says that she started the supplementary feed. Somebody was told, mother, that doctor told that by 6 months you have to start the supplementary feed, and she made an effort and she started. But her complaint is mother, baby is not liking it, not taking it. So I have no option. Therefore, I started again with the breast milk. Now the question is, when you give the supplementary food also from the outside, you have to remember some of the important aspects. See, mother should prepare the semi-solid supplementary food just equal or just more than the consistency of the breast milk. If you make it more thick, if it make it more diluted, baby will definitely not like it. It will like the same consistency of the breast milk. And you have to make the food in the same consistency, number one. Number two is breast milk is actually rich in sugar. It contains almost double the amounts of the sugar which is present in the cow's milk. So it is more sweetish. Supplementary food should be always more sweetish because baby always like the breast milk. Similarly, baby like the more sweetish substance as the breast milk is more sweetish. So you have to make it more sweetish, then only it is acceptable to the baby. So this can be added to some other taste increasing substances like jaggery, etc. to make it more taste. Now here, most of the mother, there's some, Dr. Saab, maine try kiya, wo nahi le raha, main kya karu? Okay, so then here one thing has to be very clear that baby will not change and the mother has to change. Mother has to. Many times mother come to the doctor and she expects some help from the mother, some help from the doctor. Okay, doctor can only advise, a mother has to change, baby will not change. Okay, so we have to understand the need of the baby and we have to go accordingly. Now, this is the art of the motherhood. She should continuously do in a trial and error method. She should trial with the different types of the food and then she will understand what is required for my baby, what is not required for another, what is liked or disliked by my baby. So she can add certain juices, ghee, etc. to increase the taste. Okay, this is again a trial and error method and mother should not give up. So again, if you're talking about this particular case where the greenish stool is going on, again, if the weight is not increasing, there may be excess intake of formula milk again and only, and no hind milk will be given at all. When the hind milk is not given, again, the fat is not there for the digestion of the bile and bile has no work and will just pass off. So without fat and proteins, body weight cannot increase. Every time when the baby cries, you should not feed. Okay, I explained already this particular part. So this is a case of a biliary diarrhea. What is required is, or hunger diarrhea, what is required is you have to correct the feeding habits. You have to correct the feeding habits. Now we'll go for another case, that is case number 5. Here, a 2-year-old child is presented with a loose stool. Complaint of the child is 2-year-old presented with a loose stool for the last 2 weeks. Okay, 2-year-old child, last 2 weeks he has got the loose stool. Initially, stool was watery for 7 to 8 times per day. Initially, stool is watery and it is 7 to 8 times per day. But after 2 days, the stool frequency come down. And after some treatment, he took some treatment from some doctor and stool frequency will come down. But still, mother complained that still there is 3 to 4 loose stools are going on daily. Okay, what the point? Baby had 2-year-old child, he has got the loose stools. Since last 2 weeks, the frequency was 7 to 8 times per day, but now she took some medicines. Her complaint is even after taking the medicine also, the frequency is quite decreased, but still he is passing about 3 to 4 loose stools. Again, such patients will come to you. Okay, so here on examination, baby is not sick and it is healthy. Baby is not sick and he is healthy. There is no other symptoms except that there is no fever or nothing is there, but he is passing 3 to 4 loose stools. Now, if you evaluate this particular case, before 2 weeks, the child is all right. Yes, before 2 weeks, absolutely child is all right. Then he started with this problem. So it's a matter of just 2 weeks. One thing is very clear. This is not a chronic problem. This is not a chronic problem. This is some acute problem. Some acute problem is going on. So it is not chronic because it is evidenced by the happy child. And there is no weight loss, etc. Okay. So mother is not complaining of the weight loss. She is only complaining of the loose stools. Now, then the child started the loose stools suddenly. According to mother, he was absolutely all right for 2 weeks back. Then he started the loose stools suddenly. See, anything which comes suddenly is only 2 possibilities in medical field. Many possibilities are there. As far as the child is concerned and diarrhea is concerned, 2 possibilities are there. One is suddenly started means it is a viral. Number 2, it is suddenly started means it may be allergic. Okay, so there may be either allergic or viral. So if it is allergic, one of the most common symptoms of the future of the allergic manifestation is all the allergies, they start suddenly, they disappear suddenly, and they also reappear suddenly. Sudden appearance, sudden disappearance, and sudden reappearance. This is the hallmark of the any allergic manifestations. Okay, so in this case, acute, it is acute, suddenly it is started. But if I say it is a allergic, then I should get the history of recurrences in past. But there is no history of recurrences in the past because child is all right just 2 weeks back. So it is possibly it is not an allergic case. Now what is left is it may be viral. So if it is a viral, definitely it starts very suddenly and there will be a loose stools, sudden onset, and it may be with the fever, it may not be with the fever. Most of the time the viral area may have the fever, may not have the fever, because viral fevers usually start, see how can virus enter inside the body, either from the upper respiratory tract or either from the lower upper root or the lower root. From the lower root, from the anal root, the viral infections are quite uncommon and not seen. Mostly the virus is coming from the upper root itself through the respiratory tract and GIT. So descending infection, which is started in the oral cavity or in the upper respiratory tract, it slowly comes down as the baby consumes the sputum and all. The organisms are easily given to the intestine and intestinal diarrhea starts now. Okay. So by the time the organism reaches the intestine, the fever most of the time disappears. And sometimes fever may be there, but diarrhea continues. So same is happening here also. Although he started with the fever initially, now presently there is no fever and intestinal diarrhea is going on. Intestinal viral diarrhea is going on. Therefore, he is having the stool. So now what actually happens is once the diarrhea is there, diarrhea is a devastating disease. Diarrhea is just like a flood. It demolishes everything. Okay, bacteria is not like that. Bacteria is very, very specific. It goes and localizes a particular area and causes the disease very carefully and slowly progressive. But bacteria is sudden. Okay, so it damages the villi. It damages the villi suddenly. So it takes some time for the villi to get reappear, okay, to replenish. Therefore, although now the viral diarrhea in this case is controlled, still the loose stools, see, previously he's passing 8 to 10 times, now it is only 3 to 4 times. Okay, so that itself suggests this is a diarrhea. If it would have been a bacterial cause, so this pattern will not begin. Stool frequency goes on increasing. And condition is worsening and baby will be dull and sick looking. But it is not in this case. Baby is okay and stool frequency is coming down. Definitely it is a viral fever. And you have to assure the mother that the damage has been taken place. This damage takes some time to get correct. And just wait for 3-4 days, the things will be okay. And give some Bilwadi Churna and all those things. And then the things will be clear. So this is a case of transient malabsorption after a viral diarrhea. Actually, to term the diagnosis, this is a transient malabsorption because villi are not yet formed because it is destroyed by the virus. It is not completely formed. So it's a transient malabsorption after a viral diarrhea. Okay. So such cases will also come to the clinic. Now, we have got another case. One-year-old child presented with a recurrent loose stools. The age of the child is 1 year. It is passing presented with a recurrent loose stools for the last 6 months. Problem is there since last 6 months. Each time the episode starts with the fever followed by the loose stools. Okay. Now what happens? The one-year-old child is presented with a recurrent loose stools for the 6 months, last 6 months. Every time when the fever comes, every time the loose stool starts, it is followed by, every time it starts with a fever and then there will be a loose stool. It gets better with the antibiotics, but there is recurrences. Now in this case, there is recurrent loose stools with some sort of fever. And every time it is get better by antibiotics. When you give some of the antibiotics, it will be get better. Okay. And in between the episodes, child is good and not sick. That is very important. Okay. Suppose in a 6 month, child has 6 episodes. Okay. And one episode lasting for 10 days. For the next 20 days in that particular month, the child is absolutely okay. It's good and it's not sick looking. It's playing. Okay. So now, this is seen in this case. We call it as inter-episodic period is normal. Inter-episodic period is normal. Now, in this case, it is a one-year-old child, so it is bottle fed. Mother is giving the feed by the bottle. And unhygienic child care is observed. When you see the look into the physical examination, mother is not maintaining the hygiene of the child. It is not hygienic. It is quite unhygienic. On physical examination, it is found that weight is 7 kg. See, 1-year-old child, weight is 7 kg and length is 72, and there is also some gaseous abdominal distension. See, 1 year, 7 kg, it is quite low. Okay, and the length at the end of 1 year, child gains about 25 centimeter. So 50 plus 25, it is 75. Length is not much affected, but weight is affected. Weight is much affected. Okay, usually if it is 3 kg, baby has to triple the weight by 1 year. That is 9, it should be 9 kg. Okay, so here, next we problem is there since last 6 months. So when I say it is a 6 month problem, definitely it is a chronic problem. Okay, this is a chronic problem. And it is also evidenced by height and weight is not up to the mark, especially weight is not up to the mark. So definitely there is malabsorption or malnourishment is there. Next, inter-episodes of the child are fine. Okay, when I say inter-episodes are fine, in between child is normal, I just infer that it is not an ongoing process. It is not a continuous process, some congenital problem or some hereditary problem or some infective problem which is running continuously like tuberculosis. It is not like that. Because if that is the case, how can be a child will be normal in inter-episodic period? Here the child is normal in the inter-episodic period. So it is, if it is a bacterial, inter-episode period will be abnormal and they'll be sick. Okay. So it is, but it is occurring repeatedly. No? Every month it is occurring. So again, every month it is occurring, we have got two options. Either it is a viral or it is allergic. Either it's a viral or it is a allergic. When I say allergic, allergy means not simple allergy. Allergy requires hypersensitivity, food intolerance, cow's milk allergy, then some of the autoimmune disorders. They're all immune-mediated reactions. Okay, they all comes under the purview of allergic manifestations. Now, it may be a recurrent viral infection, one of the possibility. Height and weight is decreased and it is malnourished, and malnourishment is going on very slowly. So his height is started falling early than the height. His weight is falling, started falling early than the height. 1 year, he should be around 9 to 10 kg, but here only 7 kg. But the height by the end of the 1 year, it should be 75 centimeter. Now it is only 73. So not much affliction. So it is not much progressiveness. I can say this much. If it is very, very progressive, the condition will be still worse. It is not like that because height is maintained. Height is maintained means it's good. He's getting nutrition, but weight is a little bit less. That means proper nutrition is not getting, like carbohydrate and all those things. He's not able to digest, but it is recurrent. Okay. So what it suggests that, there is some much progressive illness, less progressive illness is going on. And every time the child is getting a recurrent new infection, it is not the same infection which is continuing. If it is the same infection, inter-episodic period would not be normal. Every time, at the end of every month, child is getting some new infection every time. Child is getting some new infection every time. Now, child may be getting recurrent illness, and every time infection is new, what is the possibility? Possibility is, child may be having immunodeficiency problem. Child may be having immunodeficiency. Immune system is not up to the mark. Therefore, every time, every month, child is getting new infection. Every time child is getting new infection. So now, immune deficiency, suppose, is the cause of diarrhea. Suppose if the immune deficiency is the cause of the diarrhea, recurrence and pattern is always unusual. Every time it comes with the unusual pattern. Okay, it will not maintain the same pattern. So here also same, every time it comes with the unusual pattern. Okay, now unusual onset of the symptoms will be there, unusual progress will be there, and unusual response to the medications will be seen in case of immune deficiency causing to diarrhea, leading to diarrhea. So immune deficiency not only involves the intestine. One more thing, immune deficiency, if it is a cause, why it should only involve the intestine? It would have involved the other systems also, and baby will have all the other system symptoms also. But in this case, the symptom is only diarrhea and mild fever. There is no other system symptoms are there. So again, immune deficiency as a cause of this recurrent diarrhea is also excluded. Okay, because this pattern is not seen in this case. Now go to the next one. But there is a history of bottle feeding. See, you know, bottle is bigger, considered as biggest, bottle is considered as biggest killer of the baby. Okay, bottle feeding is considered as biggest killer of the baby. Okay, because it is responsible for so many opportunistic viral infections. So something which is coming from the outside is causing the problem. and it is not the inner problem. If it's the immunodeficiency, it's the inner problem. But here, something which is coming from the outside is causing this problem. So when the host is abnormal, then the problem is inside. When the host is normal, then the cause is from the outside. So now we'll go for a stool examination. Only if the parasite infections are suspected, then we can go for it. Here the child gives a history of bottle feeding very clear. So it is happy in between the episodes, and definitely it is some outside viral infection coming every time. Every time it is coming, a new viral infection is coming and making the baby suffer, and there is no any other background disease. So what is the diagnosis in this case? Bottle feed is the main victim here. So certain opportunistic viral infections due to bottle feeding is the cause of this type of recurrence illness. So this is the way we have to understand the process. Go for another case, that is a 2-year-old child presented with a history of loose stools. A 2-year-old child, he is presented with a history of loose stools. Abdominal pain and abdominal distension is there off and on. Over the last 1 year. That means, I mean to say, since past 1 year, child is having this problem. There is some abdominal pain, there is abdominal distension also there, and there is also loose stools going on. And loose stools are there with the mucus and there is no blood. Loose stools are there with the mucus and there is no blood. So child is exclusively breastfed up to 6 months. Now the child is 2-year-old, followed by the complementary feeding. It's followed by the complementary feeding. Mother has given some complementary feeding. Family food was introduced a few months back. Now this is important. Child is 2-year-old. Family food means that food which is taken by the other family members. Complementary food is different. Family food is different. Okay. So if the adults are taking chapati, and child is also taking chapati, that is a family food. Okay. Now child is almost active and not sick. But thing is, weight of the child is 7 kg and height of the child is 78 centimeters. See. A 2-year-old child having 7 kg is significantly less, and height is 78, that is also less, because by the end of 1 year itself child will gain 75 centimeter. A 2 year 78 centimeter is very less. That means one thing is very clear. One is 2-year-old child, past 1 year the problem is there. This is a chronic problem. Definitely this is a chronic problem, and weight and height is less. This definitely there is malabsorption. Malabsorption is clear. Okay. Now there is something which is chronic, which is ongoing progressive disease is present. This is not a static disease. This is it is not slowly progressive. It is on gradually. It's progressing, ongoing disease. Okay. In the previous case, it is not an ongoing disease, but here is an ongoing disease. Therefore, the weight is decreased so much. Now there is an abdominal pain is also present. So when I say pain, I would suspect definitely there is some inflammation, because see, pain is one of the symptoms of inflammation. Inflammation, pain, swelling, redness, etc. But that particular pain is because of inflammation. But this inflammation, as I told earlier, it may be an infective inflammation or non-infective inflammation. Infective inflammation means it is because of the virus, bacteria, etc. Non-infective inflammation means it is some sort of hypersensitivity. Okay, because hypersensitivity also causes inflammation, but it is not because of the virus or pathogen. It is because of the own body immune cell which is overreacting. So it may be hypersensitivity, food tolerance, autoimmune disease, or sometimes malignancy like disease in the later part. Okay, malignancy is also a type of hypersensitivity or immune mechanism, abnormal immune mechanism. So it may be an infective inflammation, it may be a non-infective inflammation. In this case, there is no history of infective inflammation. Of course, every time there is mild fever, it is a non-infective inflammation, because there is no history of fever and child is also not sick. If it is infective, like bacteria and all, such a long time, so definitely child will be sick and ill-looking, and there is a but such history is not available in this case. So there is no inflammatory bowel disease. It's not an inflammatory bowel disease. Now you'll see what is this. This is what I told. See here, 2-year-old child, non-infective inflammation, the possibilities are this. It may be a hypersensitivity reaction. It may be an allergic reaction. It may be an autoimmune disorder. It may be a malignancy related disorder. A 2-year-old child, autoimmune disorders are less likely, so it is excluded. Allergy, yes. Allergy may be the cause of non-infective inflammation. So when you take the allergy, we have got two important things. One is allergy to the cow's milk. Another one is allergy to the gluten hypersensitivity, wheat allergy. Okay. So this problem is deteriorated in this case. This problem is deteriorated after the introduction of the family food. What mother is telling that now it is a 2-year-old child. For the 1 year, he is absolutely normal. After 1 year, she started some of the family food like chapati, roti, etc. Once it is started, then the problem starts. Because that means after introduction of the family food, this problem starts and baby is not gaining the weight. So it is a type of non-infective inflammation which is occurring and cause maybe gluten hypersensitivity. Okay, taking the history is very important. So when the mother clearly says, as far as child is on breast milk and complementary feed, child is absolutely normal. Once you started the homemade, that means family food, then the problem started. Okay, so and that is recurrent since last 6 months. The problem is that is also weight and height is significantly decreased with the malabsorption. So problem is gluten hypersensitivity, or it is also called a celiac disease in the later stage. Okay, so we immediately have to go for tissue transglutaminase G antibody to confirm the diagnosis, TTG. Now we go for another case. 8-year-old child is presented with a history of loose stools and with a mucus and abdominal pain since last 1 month. Okay, 8-year-old child, much bigger baby now, child. 8-year-old child, loose stools is there and mucus is also there and abdominal pain is also there since last one month. And there will be occasional fever. Child is also having occasional fever and there is also loss of appetite and also loss of weight. On examination, child is sick looking. Whenever a child is sick looking, you just confirm that it's a bacterial. In viral, only during the episode, child will be a little dull. Later, child will be playing, just like viral fever. See, viral fever, child, when you give a paracetamol, fever comes down, then child start playing. Okay, and he's well. Again, after some time, again, he start the fever, again, he will be dull. And once the fever comes down, again, he start playing. This is a typical of viral, but bacteria is not like that. Typhoid fever, it's a bacterial fever. You see, child is continuously ill and sick looking because bacteria produce the toxins and virus only produce the chemicals. Okay, anyway, so on examination, there will be a sick looking child and abdomen is distended and there will be mild tenderness all over. Very clear, there is a pain is there, tenderness is there. Child is also sick looking. Definitely there is some sort of a bacterial infection causing this particular diarrhea because it's also going with the mucus. Okay, now I go for CBC. In the CBC, 22,000, WBC is 22,000. Yes, my diagnosis is confirmed. And eosinophil is zero. That is also very important. Usually eosinophil will not be with zero. When eosinophil is zero, it suggests that there will be a bacterial infection. Okay, so stool is positive for E. coli. Okay, we cannot comment on this because stool always contain E. coli. But WBC significantly rises, suggesting a inflammatory process. So this is likely to be an inflammatory bowel disease. Okay, this is typical of an inflammatory bowel disease because if you see, the HB is also decreased, HB is 7%. There's a long standing inflammatory process is there, and as a result, malabsorption is taking place and HB is also less. So this is inflammatory bowel disease, which is chronic in nature. Now we'll go for the case number one. Organizers, how many minutes I will have?
Sir, you can take more 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll go for case 9. An 8-year-old child is presented with the loose stools. Now again, 8-year-old child is coming and he's having loose stools. Okay. And the complaint is that off and on is passing that, which is varying in the frequency and consistency for last 2 months. And there is no other symptoms, no response to the treatment. Appetite of the child is normal and there is no weight loss and the physical examination is normal. See, this is quite interesting, isn't it? 8-year-old child, he's passing loose stools. If you see the appetite is normal, if you feel the growth is normal, there is physical examination is normal. And if you give some treatment, he's not responding. You have tried with the antibiotic and all other drugs you have tried, but still there is no relief. In spite of that, that means it's not responding for the treatment and there is no precise physical signs. It suggests that all the organic causes are excluded. If it is because of the organic causes, there should be one or the other physical signs. Okay, and you should respond for the proper treatment. But in this case, it is not respond for the treatment. And also there is no physical signs. So it suggests that there is no organic cause. The cause may be something, what you say, psychological cause or functional cause. Okay, it is either functional or some psychological cause. Now we have to see diarrhea due to stress. That is also that too in children. Is it possible? Yes. Children do have the stress. Small children and bigger children both will have the stress. Okay. Now see, stress in children leads to a condition called as irritable bowel-like disorder. That means just in adults we'll get irritable bowel syndrome. A similar type of presentation will be seen in children when a child is suffering from stress. Okay. In the stress, there will be autonomic overfunctioning, sympathetic, parasympathetic and all. And that leads to increased peristaltic movement and a change in the neuromuscular behavior. And as a result, there may be... Now, what is the stress in children? What can cause the stress in a newborn or what you say, infant and all? Yes, newborn may suffer with experience the stress because of separation anxiety. Okay, mother is not with the baby. Therefore, separation anxiety at home, separation anxiety at school. Okay, there may be academic stress. There may be fear or fear complex. So this is quite common in school going and preschool going children. So they are having diarrhea, the cause is stress, and that is in the form of separation anxiety syndromes. Okay, first time you're sending your baby to the preschool or kindergartens, etc. And child will often have this problem because it's experienced separation anxiety. It's leaving back the mother in the home. Okay, so this is a problem. So peer competition among, this is also the biggest problem. 8th, 9th, 10th in the high school years, the child will have diarrhea because of peer competition. Competition is increasing. Okay, and even mother is also stressed sometimes because her child only got 98%. And expectation of the mother is more. Okay, child got 98%. Why my child didn't got 99%? By taking this matter, mother is stressed. Okay, see the level of peer competition present nowadays. Anyway, so child may dislike the school environment. Child want to play with the friends, but you are not allowing. Okay, you want him to sit in a place and learn. So these are all the different stress factors which can induce diarrhea in children. Go for another case, case number 10. A 4-year-old child is presented with a history of increased frequency of stool for the last 2 months. Child is having increased frequency of stool since last 2 months. He passes very small amount of stool few times a day, besides passing a normal stool each day. Very important. What is the problem with this child is, he's a 4-year-old child and he has got increased frequency of the stool since last 2 months. But once in the morning, he passes the normal stool. In the rest of the day, he passes many infrequent loose stools. Subah utne ke baad ek bar acche se wo latrine jayega, wo acche se jayega. But uske baad later, so he starts with the infrequent stool frequently. Meantime, he has also got poor appetite and abdominal discomfort. He also soils the underwear every day with semi-solid stool. Because I told he passes infrequently after the first stools. If you are sending him to the school, in the school usually he will soil the underwear because he passes infrequently. On examination, there is an abdominal distension with the loaded hard stools in the rectum. Rectum is full of stool. Okay, loaded hard stools in the rectum on examination. And sphincters are also normal. But there is a soiling of the stool through the underwear. And you cannot say stool pattern is abnormal because in the morning he passes one normal stool. But later he has got this problem. Yes, what is the problem? By considering the above fact, there is some obstruction is there for the passing. First time he passes, but later onwards he cannot pass. There is some obstruction for the passing. Therefore, he is passing the stool in the small quantity and frequently. This is one possibility. Okay. So obstruction may lead to the abdominal discomfort also. This patient is also having abdominal discomfort. Now, if there is an obstruction, one of the most common causes of obstruction in the children is congenital megacolon. Congenital megacolon. Congenital megacolon means totally there is blockage of the intestine because of some ganglionic problem. Okay, that segment is not working. So if congenital megacolon is there, then how come the stool comes to the rectum and rectum is full? It is not possible. So it is not a case of congenital megacolon. In case of congenital megacolon, the roomy rectum will be seen. Okay, there is no stool in the rectum. It may be partial congenital megacolon. Some stool is coming and some stool is not coming. If it is a partial, then child should pass the toothpaste-like stool. because it's a partial obstruction, so child has to squeeze more or strain more to pass the stool, and the consistency or the shape of the stool will be toothpaste like. That is also not seen here, but he will have, so his rectum is containing hard stools, okay, there is no roomy rectum. So what is this? This is the typical case of what you say, this is a typical case of habitual constipation. In case of habitual constipation also you get a diarrhea like symptoms. So what is important is here, one stool baby passes normally, but later onwards baby will have this problem. This is the habitual constipation. Suppose he's going to the school and he cannot pass, the latrine is not clean, therefore he cannot pass stool, or he has to wait for the bell, and so many things are there. So some things will go into lead to habitual constipation. Nowadays usually children, they get up late, and then by 7 o'clock they have to go to the school, and by the time they don't have any time to take the food also, breakfast also, then how come it is possible to spend 10 or 10 15 minutes or 10 minutes in the toilet? It is impossible. So the child goes as if for the school, and in the school also he cannot pass the stool because of unhygienic conditions and all, or timings and all. So he gradually develops a process of a habitual constipation. So this habitual constipation also, in 24 hours, he passes one stool normally, but later in the rest of the part, he will have the problem. So this is a case of a habitual constipation. A 3-month-old baby is presented with a loose stool for the last 4 weeks. I think this will be the last case, I think. A 3-month-old baby is presented with a loose stool for the last 4 weeks, and stools are watery with the varying frequency, and there is occasional mucus is also coming, and vomiting at times is there, and not feeding well, and child is also irritable. Okay, child was normal in the first 2 months. In the first 2 months, breastfeeding was given and he was normal. And feeding is bottle feeding, formula feed they are giving. On physical examination, the weight is 3.2 kg and length is 58 centimeter, and abdomen is gaseous distension is there, and mild dehydration is also seen. She underwent 2 courses of antibiotics with soya bean milk formula, and stool is positive for the pus cells, sugar, and if you see the serum sodium 125, quite low, and potassium is 2.3, and chloride is also 95. So it clearly suggests electrolyte imbalance is there. Okay, now if you continue with this case, so again, this is a case of malabsorption or malnutrition. As you know, there are many things there, I will not go into detail. And this is another case where after introduction of the family food, again, the child started with the problems. And this is a case of gluten hypersensitivity. I think I have taken sufficient time. With this, I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. It was really informative. Thank you very much. So we will have a question answer session. One question is there, Dr. Mitushi. Take that question.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, a question hai ki an infant. Dr. Swati Tyagi ji puchte hai, an infant 2 months old has milk intolerance. Mother milk causes rashes over body, so doctors have stopped breastfeeding. His older sibling, 4-year-old, is also milk and nuts allergic. Even the children's father had milk and nuts allergy at early age. Mother has no allergy. So what can be done in this case?
Yes, this looks like a typical case of hereditary lactose intolerance.
Can you stop sharing, please, so it will be easy to communicate?
1 minute. This is a clear-cut case of lactose intolerance, which is of hereditary type maybe. So this is one of the typical case where you have to stop the breast milk. Otherwise, you should not stop the breast milk by any means. Stopping the breast milk is a crime. And this is a case of congenital or hereditary lactose intolerance. And he has got allergy for all, not only for the milk, and all milk products also. So this is the one case where you have to completely avoid the breast milk, and you have to go for the alternate milks.
Okay.
Any more questions, doctors? You can put in the chat box, please. Any more questions? So,
yes.
Yes, Dr. Mitushi.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for sharing your wonderful knowledge. I appreciate you for sharing us with wonderful cases along with case presentations and lab management, lab discussions, everything you told us about clinical examinations too. We have one more question by Dr. Lina. 4-year girl, recurrent amebiosis, mucus with stool in every 2-3 months since 3 years. And HB bore 9 GM. So we can go for stanya shodhan also, sir. Ye pehle ka jo case tha, maine aapko pucha, usme they are asking ki stanya shodhan kar sakte hai kya isme? Where you told that breastfeeding should be stopped.
No, it's not a question of if it is a hereditary lactose intolerance, there is no role of stanya shodhana. But if it is some other dietic factors and other things, so you have got the role of stanya shodhana. In hereditary, you don't have any roles. There is no medicine. Only the option is you have to change the milk. Lactose-free milk should be given. Okay. And the second case, it is told that some amebiasis and all. Actually, the chance of amebiasis, incidence of amebiasis in the infant is actually very, very less. It may occur, but it is very less. Many of the time, some other infections, dietary problems, or some disputed diarrhea, osmotic diarrhea, or misunderstood for this. Full examination and other CBC count will going to help the help us to guide the treatment. Okay, HB is less, I told, they told. So that suggests that some malnutrition is going on. So we have to do the investigation and properly we have to go for that.
So one more question is there. Dr. Varun Singh is asking, I have a patient of constipation, 18 months old baby. Their stool passes very tight. So what can be the treatment?
Tight stools.
Yes, 18 month old baby with constipation.
Yes, this is also a type of habitual constipation. Most of the time, if you are ruling out the structural problems like congenital megacolon and partial congenital megacolon and some other things, still it is persisting and none of the medicine is giving the relief, then again it's a case of habitual constipation. You have to correct the diet and you have to correct the, you have to go for the occupational therapy, behavioral therapy, everything should be given. Okay, it's because of irregular toilet training and irregular lifestyle, irregular food habits, irregular sleeping time, many things are there. Irregular food intake and irregular fluid intake. All these factors has to be corrected.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. I request Kamini ma'am and Sonali ma'am also to put some light on this topic.
Yeah. I welcome Dr. Kamini Dhiman ma'am, who is a senior associate professor in the PTSR department, AIIM New Delhi. So welcome, ma'am. And
thank you, Dr. Shilpa. It was really nice presentation by Dr. Srinidhi. And I was listening and very good cases he presented over here. And from my side, I would like to, I'm not an expert of this subject, but so many times we are dealing with gynecological and obstetrical cases. So many times mothers are visiting us that this and this thing my kid is having, what should I do and that. So at the time, being gynecologist, we advise them to have stanya parikshan. And in some stanya drushti, we have seen that kids are having such type of problem. And as per our classics, and we have done the stanya parikshan. And in that cases, sometimes patients are telling us that she is feeling that her milk is, she is not having a raised temperature, but milk is somewhat hot. That is Ati Ushna Dushti mentioned in our classics. And in that cases, we have seen that kids are having this type of problem that they are having sometimes diarrhea. And another thing is that in some females, color of this breast milk, that is Vaivarna Dushti is mentioned in our classic, that different, somewhat different. We can see that their milk is not pure white. Some changes that in breast milk. So in that cases also, sometimes kids are having this diarrhea or sometimes loose stool type of feeling. And in some cases that she is not much problem with that milk, but she is, mother is having some disturbance in her gastrointestinal system. She is having disturbed GIT. In that case also baby may feel such type of diarrhea. In those females we give generally Deepan Pachan to mother, like Sunti we advise to mother. And after that Deepan Pachan, sometimes we give, even though baby is having loose stool, even though in that case we give sometimes mild Virechan to mother to relieve dusti from her GIT, like Aragvada yeast or Aragvad is very good. I have seen in so many cases that if we give after Deepan Pachan, if we give Aragvad, in those cases also babies are getting benefit in such type of cases. Although these are clinical cases we see in our practice, but Dr. Srinidhi has very good explanation of different cases or different causative factors like allergy and viral factor and stress factor and those factors he has very good, very well explained. But this was my view that in clinically what we see the cases and kids are having see this and this problem. And another thing that if kids are not some school going kids, if they are having examination in those days also sometimes they are having GIT disturbances. The stress factor already Dr. Srinidhi explained, and this I was thinking to add that in school going children prior to examination we have seen. But as we are in the gynecology, they are not coming to us. But when breastfeeding mother are coming to us with this problem, at that time we give medicine to mothers, not the kids. Yeah. That was my.
As per our science, Dhatri, Chikitsa is also.
Right. Yes. Yes.
Dr. Sonali, ma'am. जो कि एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर है गोंदिया महाराष्ट्र से, मैम ने भी पीडियाट्रिक पे लेक्चर दिया था, बहुत बढ़िया. मैम प्लीज आप भी अपने व्यूज शेयर कीजिए.
डॉक्टर सोनाली
कहते हैं हर वैद्य में फन का राज होता है.
नाउ ट्राई फॉर अनम्यूटिंग.
यस
मैम सोनाली नाउ.
एक चिकित्सक को कैसा होना चाहिए वो सर के लेक्चर से पता चलता है. जिंदगी में जब भी प्रॉब्लम आते, जैसे प्रैक्टिस में भी कोई पेशेंट आता है तो हम सब ने क्यों के पीछे जाना चाहिए. ये बच्चे को डायरिया है क्यों है, तो वो सर हर केस में मैंने देखा सर क्यों के पीछे गए. और जनरली क्या होता है, हम लोग जब क्लिनिक्स लेते हैं बच्चों को पढ़ाते समय, पोस्टिंग मतलब पेशेंट के सामने क्लिनिक्स लेते हैं, और व्हेनेवर हिस्ट्री टेकिंग इज एन आर्ट, हाउ टू डिग अप व्हाट हैपेंड विद दैट पेशेंट. देखिए हमारे पेशेंट्स जो है पीडियाट्रिक के सर ने जो मोस्ट केसेस डिस्कस किए यहाँ पे वो सब इन्फेंट्स, या फिर जो अच्छे से बोल नहीं पाते, खुद का प्रॉब्लम नहीं बता पाते, हमको उनके प्रॉब्लम्स निकालने थे. तो हिस्ट्री टेकिंग इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. उसके ऊपर भी सर ने पूरा एम्फसाइज किया, पूरा ये किया. और जब भी व्हेनेवर जब बच्चे डॉक्टर होते रहते हैं और जब उनको अपन बोलते हैं कि व्हाट विल बी द डायग्नोसिस ऑफ दिस केस, तो एट दैट टाइम जनरली क्या होता है, कॉमन मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ अ कॉमन डिसऑर्डर इज वेरी रेयर देन कॉमन मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ रेयर डिसऑर्डर. जब व्हेन एवर वी टॉक अबाउट डायरिया,
हाँ बच्चे बड़ी बड़ी बातें करेंगे, विब्रियो कॉलरी, कॉलरा हुआ है या फिर रोटा वायरस, देन आईवी शुड बी गिवन देयर। सर ने यहाँ पे 90% केसेस जो आते हैं ओपीडी में प्रैक्टिकली वो सब डिस्कस किए। वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव सेशन, आई लाइक इट वेरी मच एंड अप्रिशिएट ऑल्सो के जो। और दूसरी एक बात, डायरिया एंड माल न्यूट्रिशन आर इंटर रिलेटेड, दोनों एक दूसरे पे ये होते हैं। डायरिया होगा पेशेंट माल रिकरेंट डायरिया के केसेस बताए सबने, सबसे ज्यादा जो वेरी कॉमन है डायरिया होगा, पेशेंट माल नरिश होगा, पेशेंट माल नरिश होगा उसकी इम्यूनिटी कम होगी, इम्यूनिटी कम होगी उसके ऊपर बिग डिसीजेस अटैक करेंगे। तो दैट्स व्हाई वी शुड ट्रीट डायरिया बाय करेक्टिंग देयर फीडिंग हैबिट्स। तो इन्फेंट्स में मोस्टली ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग, वाटर फीडिंग एंड हाइजीन, मेंटेनेंस ऑफ हाइजीनिक कंडीशन, ये सब इम्पोर्टेंट रहता है। जैसे और एक बात बताई सर ने कि एक छोटे बच्चे में सिक्स मंथ की केस में, सिक्स मंथ एज था बच्चे का और उसमें मदर ने सेमी सॉलिड फूड उसको स्टार्ट किया। तो हमारे आयुर्वेद में जो संस्कार, अन्नप्राशन संस्कार में भी जैसे काश्यप आचार्य जो बाल रोग के आचार्य माने जाते हैं, उन्होंने अन्नप्राशन संस्कार 8वें महीने से स्टार्ट करने के लिए बोला है। और जैसे वो बच्चे को अपने को अन्नप्राशन या फलप्राशन जो ऊपर का कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री फूड अपन दे रहे, दैट शुड बी एनालॉगस टू ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग, मतलब फल रस से स्टार्टिंग करते करते धीरे धीरे अडल्ट फूड की तरफ अपने को बच्चे को लेके जाना है। ये भी सर ने केसेस डिस्कस करते करते बताया। और कैसे स्टडी करनी चाहिए पेशेंट की, मतलब आयुर्वेदा के अनुसार संप्राप्ति, एक बार अपने को संप्राप्ति समझ में आ गई तो अपन किसी भी पेशेंट को आयुर्वेदा के अनुसार ट्रीट कर सकते हैं। बच्चों के डायरिया में, अतिसार में, बिलवा वलेह, कुटजा वलेह, मतलब जो चटाने योग्य है, और कुटजारिष्ट, बाल चतुर्भद्र रस, वेरी मतलब दे नो ट्रीटमेंट वेरी वेल, एवरीवन नो दीज ड्रग्स, बहुत इंफॉर्मेटिव। एंड बच्चों को मतलब हाउ टू डायग्नोस एंड हाउ टू गो टू द रियल प्रॉब्लम, मतलब जो प्रॉब्लम क्या है। जनरली डायरिया के इसमें देर इज नो नीड ऑफ प्रिस्क्रिप्शन, कन्विंस करना मदर को या अटेंडेंट्स को कि बच्चों का हाइजीन कैसा मेंटेन करें, उनको फीडिंग कैसे दें, उनको रिहाइड्रेट कैसे करें, ये ज्यादा जरूरी होता है। तो आई अप्रिशिएट दिस सेशन वेरी मच, वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव, आई लाइक इट।
थैंक यू सो मच कामिनी मैम, सोनाली मैम, थैंक यू सो मच। तो अब आगे बढ़ते हैं। हर वैद्य में हनुमान का वास होता है, कहते हैं हर वैद्य में हनुमान का वास होता है और वैद्य के लिए हर मरीज की जान भगवान लक्ष्मण के समान होती है। तो अगले सत्र को आगे बढ़ाते हुए हम नेक्स्ट स्पीकर को इनवाइट करते हैं जो कि है वैद्य रेणुका कुलकर्णी मैम। मैम है प्रोफेसर एंड HOD ऑफ कौमार नृत्य, SDM Institute of Ayurveda and Hospital, Bangalore से। Ma'am has got her UG done from Bangalore. She has present her MD from Government Ayurved College, Thiruvananthapuram. She didn't stop over here. Dr. Reena Ma'am has obtained her PhD degree too from AI Rajasthan, NIA Rajasthan. She has done her MHSC in Clinical of Child Development from Thiruvananthapuram. Ma'am is also a very good Marma practitioner. Dr. Renuka Ma'am has 14 years of teaching experience. Ma'am has published more than 45 research papers in national and international journals. Dr. Kulkarni Ma'am has touched peaks of achievement by having 2 books on Kaumar Vritya by her name. She is active member of research team, namely Suvarna Mitra Prashana. We feel proud today to hear from such a big dignitary on Ayush Darpan platform, who has been awarded by as Best Doctor Award in the year 2013, 14, 15 and 2016 as well. Ma'am has even awarded Kumar Ratna Award by Association of Ayurvedic Professionals of North America. I welcome you, ma'am, so much. We feel proud today to hear from you. Ma'am ka aaj ka topic hai Ayurveda perspective in children's gastric disturbances. Welcome, ma'am.
Over to you, ma'am. Continue. Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you, ma'am, for those kind words. Can I share the screen now?
Yeah, definitely. You are a co-host, ma'am. You can share easily.
Yeah. Is the screen visible, ma'am?
Yes.
Just a minute. First of all, I would like to thank the whole team of Ayush Darpan, especially Madam Shilpa, for giving me this opportunity. I also say my namaste to all the senior dignitaries, Dr. Kamini Madam, Dr. Srinidhi Sir, who happens to be one of the great inspiration for me, then other faculties over this platform. Then I would like to straight away start with the lecture. In fact, today's topic for discussion is common gastrointestinal problems in children and their management. Now, after listening to a brainstorming session by Dr. Srinidhi Acharya sir, who has touched all the nook and corners of various conditions, especially associated with the constipation and diarrhea, and their pathological aspects, as well as the clinical diagnosis, how to go about the clinical diagnosis of these conditions, I would like to purely concentrate upon the Ayurveda management of some of the very common functional disorders of children. Now, why we have to discuss this topic is again a thing to be known. We all know that gastrointestinal disturbances are most common illnesses in childhood, and it amounts to be around 2-4% of the general outpatient and 50% of gastrointestinology department consultations. And we know that over 5 million hospitalization in children is purely upon the gastrointestinal problems. Next, we all know that though it looks very simple for us, it's just a vomiting, but when we tend to manage those conditions, we know how difficult it is. So also the simple diarrhea which we speak is the most complicated one to handle in pediatric population. So we know that how significant morbidity and the healthcare costs are associated with these diseases. Similarly, as sir was discussing, most of these conditions, you know, involve both functional and organic pathology. Functional means here that's because of the variations with the normal cycle of digestion and metabolism or the feeding, which can lead to presentation of certain clinical manifestations of GIT. Next comes is organic pathology. We know that the abdomen, being the magic box, has multiple things in it. And every organ present in that is concerned with a specific function. And whenever there is some organic pathology, here organic pathology refers to either congenitally derived malformation of a particular organ or some tissue damage which has happened secondary to the infective or any other process, maybe an injury which has tend to present with certain problems in the clinical setup. So those are the organic pathologies. Now, we being the Ayurveda practitioners, being mostly practicing at the office level, that is the OPD practice, today's presentation I'll be concentrating mostly upon the functional problems and the functional disturbances, how we can manage with our drugs in the OPD level. Now, let us see what are the common GIT complaints we come across in the OPD. Infancy, we know that sir was discussing about this, like repeated dysthymia vomana, shula, pain, abdomen, again, then atisara, vipanda, and kshiralasaka, especially in infancy, that is children less than 1 year old. Then in children and adolescents, we are school-going children, we have certain complaints like agnimandya, jirna, mukapaka, chardi, shula, vibandha, again atisara, krimi, parikartika, and grahani. Now let us take one by one. So Stanyavamana, sir was dealing regarding the pathological aspects of this, why the child frequently pukes. Right, so in the classics it is said that pitam pitam vamati yaha stanyam. So the child keeps on drinking milk and keeps on vomiting. This has been noted as a normal physiological variation in a child, that is in an infant. And in this particular condition, the chikitsa line of management mentioned should be in the lines of udgara or chardi. So let us see regarding the what are the common causes. You know, the child who vomits after feed, normally because of the regurgitation, and regurgitation, we know that that could be because of poor sphincter control of the esophageal sphincter, or the child may be frequently swallowing the air during the feeding. So the upthrust due to the air, swallowed air, can bring about the regurgitation in the child. Sometimes maybe the faulty feeding habit or faulty sleeping habit of a child. If the mother doesn't make the child to sleep comfortably, that could be, there be some disturbance, regurgitation. So this is, and at birth, on the first day, most children vomit. That could be because of the gastric irritation secondary to swallowing of the amniotic fluid. And to clear off that, normally stomach wash is done. Even after that, if it is present, maybe a second stomach wash is required, or maybe one or two feeds with the 5% extra, then followed by the normal initiation of the breastfeed is allowed in case of newborns. But if the vomiting or regurgitation soon after feeds in about 50% babies of 3 months, is could be because of the regurgitation. And this could be as a part of, again, faulty feeding or improperly trained mother, especially the first child. The mother is improperly trained for feeding, so she can present with these things. So in these conditions, simple measures like, burping technique, how to nurse the baby in prone position. So these things would aid in management of these conditions. Sometimes there could be some the obstructive pathologies, something like, meconium obstruction or intestinal colic, they can also present with the omitting. So these things have to be understood, and we need to do vatanulomana treatment. So before we instituting to the Ayurveda treatment, we have to make ourselves very sure that there are no warning signs are associated. What do you mean by warning signs that could suggestive of the organic pathology? Say, for example, a persistent vomiting, which is projectile in nature, in a baby who is having fever and irritability, could be because of some infective pathology, maybe like encephalitis or meningitis, so that we need to know it. The same thing if it is a bilious vomiting, so there could be possibility of an obstruction down the line around the duodenum. So we need to know about that. And as I said, meconium plug also to be ruled out. Then if it is associated with the abdominal distension, so look for the conditions. If it is on the first day, say for example, diaphragmatic hernia, it's a congenital manifestations where you have, normally the abdomen of the a newborn is little protuberant. So in a diaphragmatic hernia, you have a scaphoid abdomen, and you can hear the gurgling sounds when you auscultate. So these are the conditions, where you have to pick up that whether it is because of the functional problem or any organic pathology is there. Or in a child who is developing vomiting after 2 weeks, definitely we have to rule out like congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis or duodenal atresia. Once we are done with this, once we are done with the diagnosis that the child is suffering from the functional stanyavamana, then the treatment is simple for us. Say for example, dvivarta ki phalarasam panchakolam cha lehayat. So it's a bruhati phala, and panchakola is mentioned for lehana, classical reference. And we have the pippali and panchalavana. along with the Paribhadra Churna could be given as a lehana for a child at the time of vomiting. Okay, similarly, simple Trikatu Churna is also mentioned for the regurgitation. And the Sharkara, Dadima, and Pippali, along with the Naga Kesara and Jiraka, also are the classical references which we have mentioned. Now, when we come to the clinical practice, you know, this is very important. As I was telling, you know, positioning of the baby, proper feeding technique, proper birthing technique. So we know that, just look into the video. I think everyone knows about this. If there are some students, I think they can be useful with this particular video. So this is how the baby has to be birthed. Immediately after feeding, baby has to be taken on your shoulder. Preferably such that your shoulder is against the baby's belly, so that there is a firm gentle pressure, and that aids in removal of the air which is swallowed during feeding, and the baby would burp properly. Once it is done, the baby is allowed to made to lie down. So normally in the clinical setup, what we do is, to avoid such conditions or to treat such conditions, most commonly preferred is Ajamoda Arka. Ajamoda being very mrudu virya, it's well suited for the newborns. So normally Ajamoda Arka is available in the market in the name of Omam water. So 5 drops 3 to 4 times a day before feed is the one which we advise. Casper drops is one of the excellent medicine. So Casper drops can also be used. Then we have Bonison drops. So simple regurgitations could be very well managed with this. Sometimes, you know, you get calls from the parents of the mother somewhere in the night time, or they are traveling, or they have gone to some other's place and the baby started a regurgitation. So then, you know, simple jeera water with a pinch of salt. So you can ask the mother to take around 10 to 15 ml of water, put a quarter spoon of jeera to it and a pinch of salt. So just a gentle boil it and a few drops of it, maybe around 0.5 to 1 ml of this would immediately relieve such a conditions. And of course, the burping techniques has to be taught to the mother. Now, the second problem which we come across is abdominal distension. So as it was discussed earlier, how to rule out for the cause for the abdominal distension. If the baby is having abdominal distension, little bit irritability, crying and tossing here and there and rolling, then consider, just console the baby is, mother typically says, whenever I put the baby on the ground, he starts tossing, rolling and crying. Always he would like to be picked up on the shoulder and to be patted. So this is the typical presentation which they get. And most probably this is again because of the aerophagy. And the diagnostic criteria, wrong criteria says that it should be like this presentation should be at least more than 3 times per week, extending for about 3 hours. Then only you can consider it as aerophagy. Then, you know, how can we manage? Again, the management principle is tam vatanuloma. So vatanuloma has to be done. The same drugs, you know, which we have just discussed, you know, Casper drops or Ajamoda Arka will definitely help. If at all the baby is crying and, you know, there is a frowning in the baby's face, that says that the baby might be having some pain in the abdomen. So in such condition, you know, the local procedures would aid in release of this pain and the tenseness of the abdomen. So we normally use vachachurna for this. What we ask the mother is just mix the vachachurna with little bit of nimburas. So, and warm it, and that paste is applied on the abdomen in the peri-umbilical area, or sometimes, you know, jatiphala. Jatiphala could be rubbed with the breast milk, maybe 2 to 3 rounds of the palm size, and we advise the mother to feed this to the baby as a lehana. And of course, nursing in the prone position and burping would also help to relieve such a condition. So it gives excellent results, and we very frequently practice this in our OPD level. Next comes is keeping the baby in the prone position. Normally, you know, mothers are too much worried to keep the babies in the prone position. In fact, prone position is the most naturalistic posture for the baby. So if the baby sleeps in the prone posture with a little bit drawn up the legs, you know, that gives the thrust over the abdomen, normally all the gas will be pushed out of the baby's abdomen. And most commonly, this type of distension is because of, as you know, we were discussing, like aerophagy, or sometimes, you know, slow abdomen, slow gastric emptying. You know, it is a very slow peristaltic movement, and that leads. Normally, in such children, we come across with abdominal distension in the clinical practice. Now, this the slide I would like to skip because there is a lot of discussion was done by Dr. Srinidhi on this. The Atisara and the newborn. So I'll just skip this slide. But still, again, constipation in newborn is again, normally they come. A mother comes and says, my baby has not passed stools for last 3 days or 4 days. Sometimes they come. When the baby passes only twice in a week, the motions, but baby will be feeding active and no complaints with abdomen. So in that condition, that could be a normal physiological process for the baby. So sir was discussing the pathophysiology of this condition. So if the baby is active, feeding well, gaining the weight properly, so that is the confirmatory. If the baby is gaining weight properly, then feeding well, then that should not be worried. So we can just counsel the mother that the baby is healthy. And as the baby is utilizing the most of the contents for its growth, it is not passing the stools. Or sometimes if they are, over anxious, so we can advise them to give a little bit of glucose water or extra sugar in the milk. Why this is required, mostly this kind of presentation comes with a child who is a formula fed or who is fed on the cow's milk. And we know that the casein protein, the formula protein, is hard for digestion for the babies. So that makes a little bit retention of the stools in these babies. So when we add extra water or extra sugar, so that leads to osmotic diarrhea. No, sir was discussing the pathophysiology. So that means it draws a lot of water into the gut lumen and that pushes off the stools properly. So because since the stool is dried up and mostly it was used, it was not passing the stools. Now, when you induce osmotic diarrhea, the baby is rid of the constipation. So in such conditions, very excellent home remedy is dry grapes. What we advise is we ask the mother to soak these dry grapes for about an hour in warm water. And after that, they can just bake a nice potali, or nowadays, fruit feeders are available. So these dry grapes could be put in the fruit feeders and that could be given to the baby for sucking for some time. So this dry grapes, because of saraguna, the draksha induces, osmotic diarrhea for children. And don't think when we speak of osmotic diarrhea, it draws a lot of water and that pushes the stools once or twice and it doesn't cause the diarrhea. Then we excellent remedy what we practice is Ashtachurnam syrup. So Aushadhi pharmacy has this Ashtachurnam syrup, very well accepted by infants. So we can use this around 0.5 ml once or twice a day would good enough to cause ameloma and takes care. Certain times we get a refractory type of such constipation where the parents are more having anxiety than the child. Or sometimes the child will show some signs of stool retention or habitual constipation, like crossing the legs, adopting a different posture and all. So in such condition, Aranda and Madhuprashana is excellent remedy for these children. What we ask is mother to give this Aranda Thalam, maybe around 0.5 ml, maybe 5 to 8 drops, along with 1 spoon of breast milk. So we advise mother once or twice in a week to give this early morning on the empty stomach as soon as the baby gets up. So this particular thing is given that, it cleanses the gut. So the retained stools will be pushed off. So in that way, Rudu Virechana kind of activity. So Sukumara Aranda can be used. Sometimes the baby will have the stools when you palpate, you feel that fullness, but still the baby has not passed. That could be because of the failure of the dilatation of the external anal sphincter. So a simple dilatation, maybe one can use a rectal thermometer and just dilate the anal sphincter, the baby would immediately pass the stools. And one has to keep it in this mind that no laxatives are indicated for these children. So as sir was telling, if the condition is refractory, present for a long time, and it could, one has to rule out the megacolon disorder or partial megacolon disorder or anal stenosis. And one more very important thing is congenital hypothyroidism or cretinism has to be ruled out. So you just take a thyroid evaluation of a baby before you go to treat for the refractory constipation. As I was telling, these are all the organic pathologies. So when we speak of organic pathology, the child would have some symptoms right from the beginning. So in case of megacolon disorder and all, so we'll have the history that the child did not pass the meconium as soon as the baby was delivered, or within the 24 to 48 hours, baby did not pass the meconium. That is the first indication that there could be the instance of megacolon disorder. So these things has to be kept in mind. Apart from this, mode of administration of medication also varies in case of infants. Normally what we can do is, since the direct administration of laxatives is not indicated, mother would be given Harithiki Lepa on the breast, keep it for about 45 minutes, then thoroughly wash the breast area and then feed. So by virtue of the virya of this drug, when the baby is fed with that milk, the baby would have a normal bowel patterns in the child. So there are in the traditional books like Arogya Kalpadrama, there are mention of administering Amalaki Churna along with the sugar. And Aravindasva is one of the, again, Draksha containing drug, which can be very well practiced even in infancy. Don't fear of the Asavarishta Kalpana, especially with regards to Aravindasava and Pushpasava. These two Asava Kalpas are right away indicated from the infancy. Next comes is infantile colic, that is Shuna. So sir was discussing about this. The child will be presenting with the Stanam Vyudasate Rauti Uttanasya Avabhajate Udarastabdata Shaityam Mukasvedasya Jayate. So the child will be presenting with the rolling and tossing, the distension of the abdomen and the frowning, then squeezing of the face. These are the things. And excessive inconsolable crying in an infant, otherwise who is normally looking, is an indication of infantile colic. So when to call it as infantile colic, you know, then there should be 3 episodes for at least 3 hours, 3 days in a week for 3 consecutive weeks. So then only you call it as infantile colic. So this is the typical posture adopted by the baby while crying, the baby with the infantile colic. The legs are flexed and drawn up onto the abdomen, and the fisting of the both the hands, and with the grinning and cry. So as we have discussed, you know, burping, anulomana treatment along with that nursing, you see some of the tips to release the gas and relieve the baby of colic is just doing this particular posture, you know, and alternate flexion and extension of the lower limbs, and a gentle rubbing, clockwise rubbing on the abdomen, and application of the oil with a little bit of saindhava on the abdomen, and giving hastasveda or pattasveda is going to immediately relieve the pain and the distress in the baby. So clinical practice, what we know, as I said, in the posturing and abhyanga we have already discussed. Then again, Ajamodarka, bony spasm drops, which contains Kokilaksha, is one of the very good antispasmodic drug. So very handy preparation by Himalaya company, so that can be adopted in the clinical practice. Normally in our OPDs, we prescribe either Kolicarmin drops or Carmogripes drops. They are both predominant of Ajamoda and Harithaki. So excellent remedy to relieve this kind of this shock. Then coming to the Kshira Lasaka, sir was discussing regarding the milk protein allergy as well as the lactose intolerance. So that, you know, in our classics, it's described as Kshira Lasaka, where the child presents with the varied colored loose stools associated with the features of diet dehydration. So you see Jora, Arochaka, Trut, Chardi, शुष्क उद्गार अंग भंग विक्षेप सकूजन वेपत सो ऑल आर सजेस्टिव ऑफ द डिहाइड्रेशन सो दिस पर्टिकुलर कंडीशन व्हेन इट इज प्रेजेंटिंग विद डिहाइड्रेशन इट इज कंसिडर्ड अति दारुण इन दिस इन एन इन्फेंट So, atidharana means it requires an emergency management. So, initially, as Madam was telling, bilva is one of the excellent drug to bind the stools. So, bilva peshi, that is, you know, bilva rubbed on the stone could be given. Ama bilva is preferred. If not, you know, we have the bilva leha, bilajil leha available. Bilva adigutika is available. So, those could be utilized. But when it is presenting with the dehydration, definitely baby would require hospitalization. And rule out whether it is lactose intolerance or milk protein allergy. So if it is lactose intolerance, so we have to withdraw the lactose containing milk or the breast milk for temporarily. How to identify this, you know, just ask for a stool for reducing substances. So when you estimate that if the reducing substances are more than 1%, it is a diagnostic of lactose intolerance. Otherwise, it could be milk protein allergy. So these have to be identified first and hospitalized, and child should be kept on total parenteral nutrition in case of persistent milk protein allergies. Or if it is because of lactose intolerance, withdraw the lactose containing milks, including the breast milk, and the baby would be given some formulas like, you know, Similac, Zyrolac and all. 2 to 3 days, the baby has to be treated with this. Once the baby is controlled of the loose stools, one can slowly introduce this. So we had a case of 3-day-old baby with a primary lactase deficiency. So the baby had around 10 to 15 times loose stools every day, and the baby was not gaining weight. So we just withdraw the breast milk and send the baby. And though the stool examination was not very suggestive because it was just 0.5% lactose, we still we treated it on the lines of Shira Lasaka. We withdrew this breast milk. We started with the lactose-free milk formula, and the mother was treated with the Musta Gurujarishta and Dadimashtaka Churna with the Takra. So 3 days we did this. And the mother was also given with Bilvadi Gutika. So this, you know, the Musta is again both Staneshudana as well as Atisarahara. The baby was given with again Caspar drops. And after 3 days, we introduced. Now the baby is on mother's milk. No episodes of further lactose intolerance is seen. So this is regarding the lactose intolerance. So we have already discussed, as I was discussing regarding the omam water. Then one more thing which can present with the lactose intolerance is the baby would have the periumbilical excoriation. This is typical of acid stools. So in that condition, baby would have excruciating pain while passing the stools or whenever the baby is handled for washing and all. So the local application with Shatadatta Vrata, or sometimes if it is too painful, it would require some antibiotic dusting powders along with this, you know, mix it and apply it locally, and it heals faster. Once that is done, you know, the reduction of this excoriation within 2 to 3 days, along with the stoppage of the breast milk, is indication that the baby would have suffered from the lactose intolerance. So we normally use the Panchavalkala Kshira also for the local wash, or we use the pichu pad dipped in the Panchavalkala Kashaya to treat this perianal excoriations. So that is, you know, again the spectrum of Ahiputana or Budakuta, which comes, you know, nothing but the perianal excoriation following the lactose intolerance, or even without lactose intolerance, if the baby is having the infective diarrhea and the diarrhea is for more than 10, say 8 to 10 times in a day, the baby would develop the perianal excoriations, and that needs to be treated. And for this, as I said, you know, even sometimes, you know, even without diarrhea, when the baby is on diaper repeatedly and diaper is not changed frequently, and the irritant substances in the diaper can cause the perianal rashes or perineal rashes and sometimes the perianal excoriations, the treatment line is again exactly similar. Local wash with the Panchavalkala Kvata or Trifla Kvata, followed by Jatyatigruta applications with the Yashoda Bhasma. So very fast healing, you know, whenever you have the Yashoda Bhasma, very fast healing happens. Or nowadays you get a lot of diaper rash creams available, so those can be utilized for the office practice. So this is a case of the Gudakutta, otherwise called as napkin rashes. So this is one of the case report which we treated here. 2 months baby is a female baby with excessive crying, irritability, poor feeding, rashes at buttocks. And there was a history of 1 or 2 loose stools in the previous day. So when we examined that, there is a perianal excoriation. The baby was treated with panchavalkala wash and local application of the Shatadauta Grutta. Baby was given Ajamuda Arka and mother was treated with a Mahatiktaka Kashaya in this condition. And after 3 days, you can see the change in the other foot. This was another case which we treated here, again with a case of lactose intolerance, which is presenting with a perianal excoriations. The same management was followed. This is after 3 days of treatment, you can see the changes. Now we'll move on to the Agni Mandya. It is a very frequently encountered problem in the clinical practice, and mostly so. Now onwards, we move on to the problems with the toddlers and children. Most so in case of school children. Now, why this is so common in toddler and school children? They become, you know, more fussy. They have a picky eating tendencies, and they have parental pressures to eat more. So that makes the child, you know, irritable, and they normally doesn't want to eat. And nowadays, because of this, you know, eating from the outside foods, you know, chocolates, then junks and all, you know, they don't like the homemade food, which the mother sticks on to give, think that baby should eat no spicy, no salty food, and very bland diet mother keeps on giving to the child, which the child doesn't enjoy after being habituated to eat these junks from the outside. So that makes the baby not eating frequently. Now what we have to do when we are sitting in the clinic, so we have to observe. And sometimes it so happens, you know, grandmothers get their grandchildren telling the baby is very lean. If you listen to them, no, you will go mad. Because, you know, when you examine the baby, baby's height, weight, BMI, everything is perfect. But still grandmother feels that the child is not feeding well. So if the child really the child is not feeding well, definitely there will be changes with the height, weight and BMI. So if the child is feeding well, and you just ask one question, whether the child doesn't like home food or it doesn't even eat other foods, that gives you the answer. Mother says that chips and chocolates, and if you give, the baby would eat, home food doesn't eat. That means you know the cause for not eating at home. So you have to treat for those conditions. Otherwise, if the baby is really not eating and it seems to be a little underweight, then definitely there is some pathology with the Agni, then we have to treat this condition with the appetizers. So the undernutrition means, you know, we have to follow the Ajirna, Krimi and Vibandha Chikitsa in this children. Sometimes children who are habituated for constipation, for habitual constipation, again they would have Agni Mandya and doesn't eat. So if the history of constipation is there, then Anulomana Chikitsa, Pachana Chikitsa is required. Otherwise, Agni Deepana Pachana Chikitsa is the one which is most essential in this. For Agni Deepana, normally we use Chitrakadi Vati or Arogya Vardhini Vati. Sometimes we use both. Chitrakadi or Arogya Vardhini for 5 to 7 days, maybe 1 TID in a day before food and after food for 5 to 7 days is good enough to restore the Agni of the children. Sometimes when the child is associated with the constipation, we go with Aravindasava or sometimes even with the vitamin supplements to improve the vitality in the children. Or if it is mainly Vibandha, then we go with the Kumarayasava to the Kaphaja kind of presentation to be relieved. Then if it is associated with the Pandu, like the child is not eating for a long and child is associated with features of Pandu, pallor and general weakness and all, then we go with the Draksharishta. There are conditions like, you know, the medicines like Saubhagishunti Leha and Balashabha, they're very, very well accepted. These preparations are from BV Pandit Pharmacy. So excellent group of medications for child range medications that can be utilized. When Gandharvas and little older children or school going children, we use Gandharvas Taditaila or Chirvinvadika Shaya to relieve the constipation, and both of them are excellent Agni, Dipana and Pachana in nature. So the typical, you know, we have to give typical anupana for these drugs, you know, Guda or Sandava or with the honey has to be given. Then only these things will work. Then if aversion for food is there, then we have to look in for the abdominal distension and constipation. So if associated with the aversion, then Agni Tunda would work better than along with the Kumari Asava rather than Chitrakabhuvati. Then if the child is having, you know, the psychological disturbances and it is for persisting for longer time, then we would even add Smriti Sagara Rasa in this children to relieve this habitual type of constipations. Then if Atisara is the more common presentation following the Agni Mandya, then, you know, Ananda Bhairava Rasa and Mustarishta would be useful. If the child is having the features of, like, you know, gurgling sounds, distension, sometimes, you know, the tendency of heartburn, then we add Sutta Shikara Rasa. Then traditional Musta Takra is one useful if it is presenting with the Atisara. Or Laja Dhaneka Fanta is also useful. And these could be prepared as handy patyas for this kind of children. Then Chardi is, you know, the forceful expulsion of the stomach contents. So in children, it is mostly associated with overfeeding. Normally, children are not too much greedy of food. When they feel full, you know, normally they say no for food. But it is the mother thinks that, oh, my baby has eaten only this much food, and she tries to overfeed the child. And that develops the aversion for the child. And this overfeeding would definitely bring about the Chardi in children. Unless until associated with any organic pathology, the overfeeding Chardi can be very well managed. So a simple give some Chardigna, Anulomana, Dravyas. Normally we use Patyadipada along with the Sutta Shikara Rasa. Or sometimes if associated with constipation, we do add Haritiki tablet. So or sometimes in a very young child, and these all medications is not been able to give, simple Ingvashtaka Churna along with the first morsel of the food, or Ashtachurnan syrup we are using for the management of this condition. Excellent remedy, you know, maybe 2 to 3 days. I had a child of 2 months old who had vomiting for about 1 month, which was not relieved by any anti-emetic drugs of this one. Child was simply treated with this Madhifila Rasayana and Dhanvantara Gulika, and child is excellent now. No episodes of vomiting after starting this particular treatment. So if it is Paitika Chardi, you know, Paitika Chardi usually presents with the distressing features. So the heartburn, the pain, the headache, sometimes, you know, increased Trishna, you know. So in such conditions, along with Madhifila Rasayana, please add Kamadhuga Rasa, either plain or with Mukta, based upon the nature of the child. And of course, Dhanvantara Gutika. If associated with, then Shankavati can be added. Then Mayura Pachya Bhasma is one of the such medications, you know, when you don't understand the pathology, why the child is continuously vomiting, or irrespective of the pathology, if you want to give, you can give a pinch of Mayura Pachya Bhasma mixed with the breast milk or in a plain water. So excellent remedy, it controls all types of vomiting. So if it is sometimes, even the vomiting sensation is because of the blocked plugging of the mucus, the baby would vomit and remove the plugging of the mucus and relieved of Chardi. So that's how it's a very excellent, you know, it also improves the early gastric emptying is done with the Mayura Pachya Bhasma. So the recurrence of vomiting would be very less when you are using Mayura Pachya Bhasma. Then Pravada Pishti and Kapardika Bhasma. Nowadays, children do come with the gastric irritation problems because of this outside eating, junk eating. They do develop this Amlapitta kind of presentation. So when the child is presenting with Amlapitta kind of presentation, if it is Shula Pradana, then one can definitely use Pravada Pishti or Kapardika Bhasma. In about, you know, one to two pinches, the dose what we use in the clinical practice. and advise the mother regarding the feeding habits of the child. And gulkand, use of gulkand prevalent maybe once or twice in a week will reduce the recurrence of these conditions. And if the child is presenting with acute spasmodic pain, so katuki churna with madhu, you know, excellent, you know, it acts as antispasmodic. Relieves the pain immediately in the child. And of course, you continue with your regular homeopathic management. So if the child is presenting with a vomiting, a no retention of the food, child is feeling very weak, then what we advise is we put the child on larger tarpaulin. We definitely admit the child, watch the vitals of the child, and put the child with a larger tarpaulin. Larger tarpaulin is like, you know, larger, you might be knowing everyone. So larger is boiled with around 6 times of water. And this water, we ask the mother to give it in sips, like, you know, ORS, 5 to 10 ml, frequent sips over next 2 to 3 hours. So this, you know, prevents the draining out of the child and it reduces the vomiting. So the larger is charbigna, so it reduces the vomiting. So whenever if the child is presenting with acute dehydration features, child is sick looking, fever is there, then definitely, high grade fever is there, high pitch cry, headache. So these are things, you know, the suggestive of the organic pathology. If organic pathology are there, if you can identify this, and definitive treatment is required. So if no organic pathology is identified, this treatment would maybe continue for 1 or 2 days, would settle down the problem with the child. So this was, again, the Nishan was an 8-year-old child who presented with a similar complaints, pain abdomen with vomiting, and on history, we inquired the history. Initially, we did not get the history, but on specific poking and inquiring, child had continuously 3 days gobi manchuri outside. And he presented with that acute retrosternal pain, and then he started with the vomiting and pain abdomen. The child was put on kanduga with mukta, anantravati, and amlapitta mishrana. So when the child came with acute episodes, we definitely had given one dose of MSAID injection. But with that only the child settled. The child was treated for next 3 days with these medications and was relieved of the complaint. Next, Vibandha is the one which was most discussed in the last session. So we have to identify Vibandha. How does it present? Purisha Vandha. So it could be because of Vatavarcha Apravrati, not able to pass, or Chirat Pravrati. The child is passing stools, but the interval is longer, that is Chirat Pravrati, or Alpamatra Pravartam. The child is passing skybolas, you know, hard pellet-like stools. So these could be the presentations in Vibandha. And more so, especially the children fed with the formula feed or less fluid intake and less fiber intake. So the feeding child who has not had the proper feeding training or transit over the regular food, these children usually present with this complaint. You know, in the photo you can observe, there is, you know, the typical constipation posture of the child who is habitual constipated, who tries to avoid the urge of defecation, and this has to be identified. So now the line of treatment is Yadvayor Analomia Yad Agni Balavarte. The treatment should be the analomana as well as Agni Balavartan. So that could be in the form of Anna, Pana, and Aushadha. So one can even utilize the measures like Vasti, Niruha Vasti, Sneha, Vireka, for anulomana of these children based up. If there is mild constipation, only oral medications is good enough. If it is Chirak Pravati or Skybolas, then you may have to give Niruhavasti or Sneha Vireka, which is useful in these procedures. If the child is gaining weight, eating well, but it is overstaying, stasis of the stools in the gut, you know, Shrikara Bala Sanjeevini is one of the excellent remedy again from B.V. Pandit Pharmacy. So you can give one tablet to the child every night. So the child may have 1 or 2 stools, which is little bit watery, but it only acts at the level of the GIT, just clears the gut. So it doesn't have any systemic activity. so it can be used. Sometimes if the child starts complaining, then that is the sign that you have to stop this medication for some days. So then otherwise the Trivrut Leha or Sukumara Erenda, Sukumara Leha or Rudra Virachana Lehas are available. These can be given for about a week or 10 days continuously. In little older children who goes to school, you know, not what we do is we administer this Anuloma DS tablet continuously for 10 days. Now, why this 10 days is the duration required? Because now the child is having a habitual constipation. One time relief of the stools is not going to solve the problem. So we give it for compulsorily for 10 days, even whether the child is passing or not, compulsorily the mother has to give this medication for 10 days. Along with that, we advise the mother for a diet modification. We advise them the local pichu at the time of sleeping, usually with Erenda Taila, local pichu, or sometimes with Jatyadi Taila if Parikartika is there. Then we advise them a playful session before taking the baby for toileting. So this, you know, the relieves the fear of that pain or strain which the baby has to apply to pass the stools. Once the baby is free of this, you know, the sense of pain, the baby would be adopted to the normal routine following. Now, once again, the toilet training is a process of habituation. So you have to make the child to pass the stools every day regularly in a particular time, and a discipline has to be put. And these drugs, you know, though they are little bit tikshna, they help us to put the baby for a discipline of passing the stools regularly. And that is more essential to treat the habitual constipations. So we use these particular drugs. In case of mild constipation, Haritiki Khanda we advise. Haritiki Khanda Pavman Pharmacy. So around 1 spoon of this, 5 grams of this Leha with the milk in the night bedtime is good enough to clear the habitual constipation in children. So as I was discussing, Parikartika, that is, you know, the fissure. Fissure, you know, is the most frequent complication associated with a constipation. So we treat usually with Jatyadi Taila Pichu or Jatyadi Vrutta with Yashada Basma if too much wound is there. And 6 baths with Panchavalkala Kuvata is good enough to treat condition to prevent the further fissuring. Night time we advise local Pichu at the anus with Erenda Taila. So this has been the regular practice. So there was a case. 6-year-old boy with a hard stools, pain while passing stools, with occasional bleeding per rectum, reduced appetite, bowel frequency was once in 3 to 4 days. And normally the child used to resist to pass the stools because of the poor toilet training. And this has been for months together for the child now. Now the child was on oral lactulose therapy and the child had been a very fussy eater and his thyroid profile was normal. So now initially we treated this child for 10 days with our regular protocol of Anuloma DS along with the Kumari Asava and increase of fiber diet and the fruit eating for the child. But it did not relieve the problems. So later the child was treated as an inpatient and was given Gandharvastadi Erenda Taila Vasti for 3 days, Anuvasana Vasti, followed by Sukumara Vrutta for next 4 days. Along with this, the child was put on discharge, the oral medication, Sinvastika Churna, Sukumara Vrutta for next 7 days, along with the diet modifications. By the time the Basti course was completed, the child was having a disciplined toilet training and the complaint of the problem was relieved. So this was his report. This was another child who presented with the Vibandha, the child. See, this is the Vibandha of weaning period. The child was fine till the age of 6 months. After 6 months, the child was started with the weaning, the complementary feeds. The child was given the diet like oats khichdi, rice khichdi with vegetables. Then jeera water was being given to the child by the mother. But still the child was passing stools once in 3 to 4 days. Rarely it was blood stained and it was more strainful for the baby. So in fact, it was one of the very staff of our institute they brought this child. The child was given this again, Eranda Madhuprasanna was advised, along with the dry grapes as the Phalaprasanna for the child. And the mother was on history. We noted that mother was a known case of habitual constipation. Though she was not having any associated complaint, but she had the tendency of constipating. So the mother was treated with Anuloma DS, and she was advised the diet changes. And this protocol was followed for next 21 days, in fact, and the child was relieved of the complaint with this. Now the child is very fine and eating and having a proper weight gain. Now this is another case where the child presented with Vibandha with Agni Mandya. And again, this child was admitted. Initial treatment was not useful for this child, was admitted and was given the same protocol. The Anuvasana Vasti with Sukumaragrita and Anuloma DS was given. And on discharge, still there was a bit of constipation was complained by the mother, and baby was continued with Anuloma DS for one more week just to put the baby for the discipline. And the diet modification was advised. Now we move on to the Atisara. Atisara, sir, has explained very well all the pathophysiological aspects. I'll just go to the management. So whenever you feel that there is no organic pathology and it's a functional disturbance and it is of acute onset and you find Amavastha. How do you find Amavastha? There is a foul-smelling stools and the stools, stinking stools. You know, even after the baby passes stools for some more few minutes, the area gets stink. You know, that is the nature of ama in the stool. And in a child, you know, if you ask, the child typically says as soon as the child passes, the whole matter sinks, but it presents with a very stinking smell. So Mustakotija Rishta is the drug of choice along with the Dadimastika Churna with the Takra. Kutija Ganavati, Bilvaleha. Why Bilvaleha is, again, it's a Pachana, very good Pachana Dravya. Sometimes if it is in a very, toddler age group, we treat this condition with the Balachaturbhadra Churna along with honey. You have Balachaturbhadra Churna available for this Vaidyaratnam Pharmacy or Shridhariyam, so that can be utilized. Or either Dutha Papeshwar has a Balachaturbhadra syrup also, so that could be utilized. Sometimes if you find that Samajirna and it is osmotic kind of presentation, then don't advise syrups. Syrups are going to increase the Atisara. So that time it is the better always. And if you look into the Charaka's chapter of Atisara, most of the drug mentioned are in Churna Pharma itself. So the Churna Pharma for excellent for Amatisara. In case of Niramavastha, we go for Velvadi Gutika, Kudija Rishta, and you have a diuretic syrup by Himalaya. In case of toddlers, we can utilize that. If Atisara associated with the fever, then Ama Lakshanas are there, then we go with Anandabhairava Rasa along with Mustaka Rishta. If you suspect this Atisara with the fever could be because of waterborne infections with the history, then Sanjeevani Vati is the drug of choice. Excellent. You know, we have treated children even without any IV fluids and without any antibiotics, we have treated these children. Then if the child is presenting with the features of dehydration already, then it is, you have to have a backup. Because you cannot take any chance when it comes to children. Then if it is Atisara associated with the mucus and straining, so Kaidaryadikasha, it is presenting with a Pravahika Lakshana. So it is Kapha predominant in nature. So in case of Kapha predominant means we have to go with the Kaidaryadikasha, which are Tikshna as well as Pachana in nature. Grahanyantaka Rasa can be given. Prajanyadi Churna is again one of the very handy choice, and you have again, this one, Kudija Ganavati is again one of the thing which we can utilize to control the Atisana after you're sure that there is no more straining is present. So this is, and Ruddha Gangadhara Churna or Pancha Sama Churna are excellent Pachana medications to relieve this Pravahika. So those can be utilized in the clinical practice. And if it is associated with the bleeding, once again, Pushanaga Churna with the rice wash or the Ganji or even with honey, excellent one to control the Raktapasara in case of children. Sometimes we do even give Dadimatvaka boiled water for the children for the control of Raktapasara. So as I said, if it is a very mild dehydration which could be managed, so we admit the child and we keep a watch on the child and we give frequent Rajamanda, then Marifala Rasayana diluted in water. We ask them to take it like a ORS, you know, very frequently, so that reduces the episodes of dehydration. And along with that, you know, we can even ask this Dadima Ashtaka Churna mixed with the Takkara could also be advised. As a rule, after the control of this diarrhea, we give oral zinc administration. Either zinc syrups are available that you can give, or you can give something like Madhumalini Vasantarasa or Lagumalini Vasantarasa are used in the clinical practice to heal up the damaged mucosa in case of Atisara, which is presenting with organic pathology. So this was in a case of Atisara. In fact, it is a case, you know, Dantodbheda Janya Atisara. The child was treated with just simple Mebarid syrup, and the mother was given Mustagudja Vishta just to relieve the pythika features, and the child was okay. In fact, no medications were required, but since the child was having persistent the loose stools for 2 days, we had to give this particular medication. So this is again another child, baby of Rupa. It was a child. It was of 6 months old. Just a minute, not six, 1 year, 6 months old child. 1 year, yeah, 1 year, 6 months old child was presented with a loose stools two times since the morning. There was no history of fever, but the child had runny nose. The child was treated with the Mebarid syrup again and Vetumaran Gulika. So this was the case, another case which we managed in OPD. Now we'll move on to another complication, that is with Guda Bramsha, Pravanati Sarabhyam Nirkachati Gudam. Whenever there is excess straining, either due to constipation or due to chronic diarrhea in children, the child can present with a rectal prolapse. So if it is a complete prosodontia, there is very less role of us. So we have to look for, it's a grade 1 or grade 2. We can very well manage in the clinical level. So what we normally do is we give Atanulomana with the Sukumara Leha and Anuvasana Basti with Changeri Gruta. So if available, one can definitely use either Shashtika Taila or Unjari Taila, but not so frequently available. So Changeri Gruta we normally use for the Anuvasana Basti for these children. And this is the procedure of Anuvasana Basti. This, of course, was done for some other case of skin disease. This I'm just showing you the procedure. So how to introduce Anuvasana Basti for children. So catheters are must, especially in case of Buddha Bramsha, because if you try to introduce Basti Yantra, sometimes you may damage it. So the soft-edged catheters are very must useful. And sometimes, you know, we can teach the parents regarding the digital reposition of the prolapsed rectum. So local Avagaha Sveda would be given. Avagaha Sveda either with Dashmula Kashaya or with a Panchavalkala Kashaya, based upon the pain and this one, we can select the Kashaya, followed by a digital reposition. And tight fitting, nappies has to be advised for these children. And even in night times, if possible, the local picture application is also useful. Normally, children will not cooperate for local pictures. So what we do is we do on Vasanavasti practice. So this was a case who was treated with the rectal prolapse was treated with on Vasanavasti. 7 days. The child is fine now. Then this was another case who presented with a rectal prolapse again, and you can see here this was constipation predominant. Guda Brahmisha was there, so we had put the child on, it was a 3-year-old child, we put the child on anuloma tablet along with Raksha Rishta and the sitz bath with Panchavalkala Kashaya and Pichu with Changeri Gruta and Vasanavasti with the Changeri Gruta was done for this, Matra Vasti with Changeri Gruta was done for this child. This child is again fine now. It was recently treated in the month of February. Then Shula is again functional abdominal pain. We have discussed a lot on Shula. Just say if any involvement, if it is a very acute pain and a functional pain, you think that there is no organic pathology, Nabhivati, and an excellent remedy. It was an acute relief of the pain. Containing Vatsanaba only. So it's of SDM pharmacy. Unfortunately, recently it has not been manufactured from SDM. So then if the child is having any stressful events and the child is presenting with the fear of going to school or the homework is creating Shula, then definitely Manas Mitravati could be along with Saraswata Rishta. Or Krimignavati along with the Saraswata Rishta are useful this one. And if you find that the child has any history of disturbances, gut disturbances, and would have led to the spasmodic pain, then one can use the Himcospaz, excellent preparation from Himalaya, can be used to relieve the pain. So this was again, there are a few cases with the Shula. I think I skip because of the time. And I think it will be last case. Maybe another 2 slides are there. I will move on to Krimi. Krimi is again one of the very, very frequently met the problem in case of children. So how do you identify Krimi? So there is a Sanjata Krimi Lakshanas. Jura Vivaranata Shulam, Rudrogas, Sadhanam Brahma, Bhakta Dvesha, Atisarasya, Sandhata Kimi Lakshanam. So you have the typical presentations with the Krimi Koshta. So then the classical drug preparations, I think everyone are familiar. I'll just go against what is done in the OPD practice. So we had a case of 5-year-old girl with recurrent abdomen pain, periumbilical, with a refusal to feed, then fullness of the abdomen with irregular bowel habits. There was no history of vomiting or anal itching. So there was a history of passing worms, round worms, long worms, and she was treated with albendazole at every 3 months. But still, the child would present with such features. Then we diagnosed this case as Krimi Koshta, and it is because of Purishaja Krimi. Then we started her with Krimi Kutara Rasa, one tablet twice a day for a week, along with Kampilaka Churna and Avipatikara Churna with Guda for 3 days to induce mild Virechana for this child. And after Virechana, the child was asked to continue with Vidanga Rishta for next 1 month. The child was, after administration of Krimikutara and Kampilaka, we have seen her passing, bowls of the round worms. Heaps of round worms were seen when she was passing stools. So this has been an excellent experience for us. And the use of this Krimikutara Rasa and Kampilaka Churna in the treatment of Krimi. This was again another case which was treated with Krimikutara Rasa and Vidanga Rishta. If the child is presenting with Kafaja Krimi Lakshanas and Shula is there, Guruta is there, Bhakta Dvesha is there, Ajirana, Asya Prasika is there, then Bhunimbadi Kada along with the Krimikutara Rasa is very useful. Or we get one Krimi Shodhini Gulika from Aryavaidya Kotakal Pharmacy, again excellent one for 7 days, 1 week course of Krimi Shodhani Mulika relieves almost all kinds of worm infestation in children. Then in case of this Mukapaka, next we'll take up the case of Mukapaka. So we know that Spotaihi Stasatodai Rityaya Vata is a Sarvasara Roga. So you have to identify whether it is Vata predominant, Pitta predominant or Kapha predominant. How do you identify? If it is Spota along with Tivra Vedana, it is Vataja. If it is associated with Daha and you know that external red lining is there for the ulcers, then you call it as Pitta. Then there is no much pain. The shallow ulcers, white in nature, again that goes for Kapha. So what we normally do, how we treat is the use of Kamaduga, Rasa, then Saptachadadi Gandusha, Trifala Churna and Eshti. This is our trump card, Trifala Churna and Eshti in the treatment of Mukapaka. If we have the Stomatop gel and Stomatop capsules available from Sagar Pharmacy, again, very nice medications to be used in the clinical practice. And you know, spinaches are excellent to relieve the pain and the recurrence of this one, Mukapaka. This was, you know, this was treated in our OPD again. A 9-year-old child, male, with the mouth ulcers, painful on and off for last 3 months. And on history, the child had a severe constipation. So there was no history of travel, change of food or medication. And the ulcers were multiple and shallow with acute pain. Child was slurring to speak. So this was the presentation. The child was given internal administration of Trifala Churna with Eshti Madhu, along with warm water, along with the same for Kashaya, for Gandusha. And Gandhaka Rasayana was given. And Kadira Rishta, 5 ml TID for 5 days. The child was treated. And the child was advised to take lots of spinaches and, you know, this copra, the kobari and the Kannada Dave. So that was advised for the child to chew, and by 5 days, the child returned happily. His constipation was relieved. His painful mouth ulcers were relieved, and he was very happy. And the child was later treated with Aarogyavardhini Rasam, Rakshadi Kashaya, for next consecutive 3 weeks to avoid the recurrence. And the child was...
Sorry, Madam, just another session is at 5. So...
Yes, this is the last slide.
Yeah.
Ma'am.
Sorry to disturb. Yeah.
And this is another case which was treated with Mukapaka. So I think these are the very common limit conditions. Sometimes we do get the oral candidiasis or oral thrush in case of infants. So normally what we advise is application of the mixture of madhu and gruta is good enough. And if it is very thick oral thrush, you know, sometimes we advise even use of little bit of tankana along with this mixture to relieve that oral thrush and relieve the condition of Mukapaka. And as I said, you know, the usual associate with vitamin deficiencies as well as constipations has to be ruled out with history, and that has to be taken care. So I think with this, we have taken very common functional problems which we come across in the OPD practice. I would like to thank again the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity, and the audience for their patience hearing. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was really wonderful brainstorming, and it is, I'm sure it is very useful for our practitioner doctors who are watching on the FB also. So thank you very much for the wonderful presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
So if there are any questions, you can put into one question is there, ma'am, the most common disease of bed wetting.
Yeah.
So what can you suggest in bed wetting as per Ayurveda perspective?
Well, again, bedwetting, you have to rule out the organic causes, just rule out the recurrent constipation or any history of spina bifida, meningioma, neural tube defects has to be ruled out. And if nothing is there, just check for the bladder capacity. If bladder capacity is also normal, then we have to treat. Normally, children have a habit of taking a lot of water. So some psychological interventions, some dietary modifications, like we advise no water after 6 or 7 p.m. in the evening. And a local abhinga, we advise along with this ashwagandha balala akshadhitena. The internally we give normally punanava mandura along with the tablet neo or vishamushti vati, which is very good in toning up the bladder as well as the perineal muscles. We do advise them certain set of yogasanas like, you know, pavanamuktasan, then baddha kona kriya, then setu bandhasan. These are very typical of the management of bedwetting. So a regular practice for about 2 to 3 weeks with these medications and alarm therapy, we ask them to wake up night in once and rewarding, you know, the positive reinforcement. All these things has to be, you know, it is has to be added comprehensively in the OPD level, and we get excellent results, right? And once the initial control is there, you have to add some of the Maitha Rasayanas as a follow-up therapy in case of bedwetting.
Thank you very much. So, Dr. Mitushi. Dr. Sonali. Ma'am, can please will you stop your sharing now? Dr. Yes. Enos?
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, Dr. Sonali.
Very, very informative session. I am confirmed that viewers will watch this session again and again. Madam covered almost problems and clinical patients coming in your general OPD from right from Mukhapak to Gudapak. She covered all topics with various options of treatments. Excellent session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yeah, ma'am. Various treatment modalities you have suggested, like local application and internal medicines along with the panchakarma procedures. So it was really wonderful. But as per the time schedule, I think.
I understand.
Yeah, because it's too long from since to we are here on the screen. So thank you very much. Yes, Sonali.
Shown practical of basti in children, that is icing of cake of this session. Very well.
Yeah, definitely. It was really wonderful to see in the children's, ma'am. It was really nice. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. We have a separate panchakarma unit in our institute. We practice around 1,500 panchakarmas in our OPD practices. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Mitushi.
Yes, ma'am. So, thank you so much. You have really proved your award of best doctor award. We appreciate you for sharing so many cases, and you have not even left single organ and GIT track. It was worth listening to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, so shall we end the program?
Yeah. So, vote of thanks for all of the viewers, Doctor, all the doctors, speakers, and the chairman and co-chairman. Yes.
जी मैम. ना महकी फुलवारी होती, खुशबू के घर ना होते, राधा की पायल, कान्हा की वंशी के स्वर ना होते, मौत घरों में मातम कर देती यदि ये डॉक्टर्स ना होते. तो ऐसे ही होनहार डॉक्टर्स को हम प्रणाम करते हैं, एंड थैंक यू सो मच फॉर टू today's speakers, Dr. Srinagar sir and Dr. Renuka ma'am, our chairperson Dr. Kamini ma'am, co-chairperson Dr. Sonali ma'am, डॉक्टर शिल्पा मैम, अरविंद पाठक सर, नवीन जोशी सर, सबका थैंक यू सो मच. एंड वी थैंक यू बोथ द स्पीकर्स ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आयुष दर्पण टीम. एंड होपफुली वी विल बी फॉर्चुनेट इनफ टू यू लिसन टू लिसन टू यू वंस अगेन.
या डेफिनेटली. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच. एंड आई एम ग्लैड टू शेयर दैट वी हैव ऑर्गेनाइज्ड अ वेरियस कॉम्पिटिशंस फॉर UG and PG students. I'm sharing the data. We have already shared on the Facebook page of Ayush Darpan, on the Kutum application and the Telegram application. So it's a nice opportunity for your students of UG, PG, and also there is one opportunity for you teachers also. There is a Best Teacher Award from Ayush Darpan Foundation on an occasion of Ayurveda Day, National Ayurveda Day. So you can go with that form and you can fill all the details with that. It's a nice opportunity to get award or to get deal with such type of rewards. So thank you very much all from Ayush Darpan and Namaskar. So we are ending the session. So bye bye all and take care. Namaskar.
Thank you.